No, the beans didn't roll. They're on the X contract, 126,000. Yeah, and definitely staying on the X on those soybeans. X is November, yeah. That's right. X is November. Yeah, I don't know what they do it that way with Ninja. They force you to put in the actual month. If you want to see, well, if you're using Ninja, this isn't going to help. But if you were using TT Pro, you would just go to Help, Contract Specs, right there. I guess, you know what, you can just go to the Daniels Trading website and do this, because that's what it brings up, is a page here at the Daniels Trading website. January, February, March, April, May, June, July, August, September, October, November, December. You see all the letters for the months? They're right there. So you can go through all this. Okay, futures, the energies, the currencies, financials. You can see what exchange they're actually on. If you want to see that.
So what's spec on beans?
Beans, if you go to grains, soybeans are, they're the X contract right now, November contract of soybeans. Here it is, ZS CBOT. And they're on the X contract right
now. So the next contract will be F.
I believe the next contract would be F, yeah.
And if you click on the highlighted soybeans, it'll take you to the soybean page. Down where you were.
Yep, down here. Mm-hmm. Click on that.
Yeah.
There you go. And central time.
Does that give you any additional information on the date that it rolls? That's what you're looking for?
It does not, but you know, you can see it goes from November beans, the X, to the January, to the F, to the March, to the May, to the July, to the August. The business day prior to the 15th calendar day of the contract month is when it terminates. So the business day prior to the 15th day. So in November, I guess it does give you more information. So in November, the 13th will be the last day for November beans, but the new contract will probably become available around the 6th, the 5th or the 6th of November. Okay, so you'd probably be looking for that. All right,
so right now in soybeans, we're ZSX1.
ZSX5.
I mean ZSX5. So let's see what the volume today is, or in this past hour. We had a grain report today, huh?
There was a report that came out, yeah, at noon, but okay. It's not the WASD report though.
No, it's not. 106,000 contracts traded today in the X contract.
And it should be.
Take a look at ZSF6. We've got 11,000, so we're still a good ways from the roll, probably a week or so.
Yeah.
Week or two.
From the roll on the beans, did you say? We should be more than a week. We should be like a month.
Well, tomorrow is the first day of October, and it says delivery is on the 15th of the month prior to the month you're trading. Isn't that what you just read?
No, it's 15th on the business day prior. It's the business day prior to the 15th of the month. And let me go back and read it again. Here it is, soybeans. It says business day prior to the 15th calendar day of the contract month. So it would be the 13th of November would be the termination of trading. And the new contract for soybeans will probably become available a week before then. So you'd probably be looking at the 6th of November. Okay, because the 15th is on a weekend, so the 13th is the day that the termination of trading happens. That's Friday. So.
Well, there you go. There's the answer. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that, I was just typing that in for you, Bob. You had ZB1215. That's bonds. And that's correct. The bonds are in December, but you want ZS1115 for Ninja. Okay.
All right, let me grab the charts.
Okay. All right, and a reminder to everyone, there's a partners meeting tonight, 9 p.m. Eastern Time. The link for that will be sent out around 6 p.m. Eastern Time.
Okay, this is the thing I was telling you about earlier today in the live trading room. Okay, we're on a four tick range chart of the ES. Do you see that? You see down here?
It's got
one more tick to go. Now, apparently, it only counts in the direction that it initially starts. Watch and see what happens when it goes to this next candle. It says one right there.
Yes.
It needs to go one more tick to the upside. I didn't watch it long enough last night. Okay, so one more tick. Come on.
Watch. It's going to take 10 minutes now.
Probably.
It is ES.
I can put it on something faster. Oh, it just moved. Okay, so see now.
Yep.
It's showing two ticks.
Yep. Yours is showing it up on the top too, though.
Yeah.
You know, I have a different version than you. That must be what it is. I don't do the upgrades all the time.
But see, from where it's at, it can't be two ticks in both directions because it opened there. From there, it could be two, but from there, it's not two. I'm trying to figure out if people can put this to use or not.
I don't know.
Have to watch its behavior. Guys, just the way you turn that on, if you weren't in the live trading room today, you just open this up, go up to countdown timer, turn it on. Now, the reason I noticed that was because yesterday when Jonathin was with us, we switched to a five-minute chart, and then I went back to the four-tick range, and I turned on the time for the purpose of the five-minute chart. And I was explaining how with two charts, see, with the range chart, we can know where we're going to get our next candle. Can also know when. On a time-based chart, you can count it down 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and you're going to get another candle whether there's been price movement. It's not a volume issue, it's not a price issue, it's purely time-based.
Yeah. Look at a 1 minute ES at about 2 o'clock in the morning and you just see a whole bunch of flat lines. See some of those over there. Oh. There was a couple.
I missed those.
Now you got it back to an hour. You're on.
Now I hit the wrong chart.
Yeah.
There we go.
See, there was one right there at 20:55. Anywhere there's just a flat line, there's a couple there.
Yeah, it's more active of late than it usually is, a kind of a flat line. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's 1 minute. See, it's counting down 4 seconds. 3, 2, 1, and then boom, another candle. Now, In exactly 1 minute, you'll get another candle, unlike the four tick range where it's all price driven. Like so. All right, and it's counting it down. All right, buddy.
All right.
I got it from here.
Okay.
All right, guys. We're going to go to our good word for the day, and then we'll take a look at some of the concierge trade alerts. Then we'll go talk to David at Page Trader, and White Bar Jim should be joining me today. Those of you that were here yesterday at the close of the show, okay, we drew a trend line, okay, from this high to this high and extended it. We then created a parallel of this trend line and turned it into a price channel. 1, 2, 3. You can start here. 1. Got to have 3 touches. All right. Then we put this dotted line in the middle. Why? Because as the story goes, if you've read any technical analysis books, once price gets back to the middle of the channel, it's a coin flip if it's going to go to the bottom of the channel or return to the top. So what did it do? It got to the top, it got to the middle, back to the top, back to the middle, back to the top. Here we poked down. We talked about this at length yesterday. If you missed yesterday's video, go and grab that. Watch the very last part of the show. We talk in depth about what's going to happen here, what's potentially going to happen, okay, because this was the low of the session, low of the week. We had done this little bit of rally, and so we were watching it as it came down. We came within 2 ticks. It looks like it touched it. Okay, see the swing low here was 1861. And the swing low here was 6150, so we got within 2 ticks. I want to go through all the reasons of why this type of phenomena happens. Now, if we look left, do we understand why this happens? And now why we're turning back down at this area? See, it's all in the chart, and it's there ahead of time before it happens. Before this happened, because of this, we had every good reason to believe that this would happen. Now, we did not know it would happen to this degree. We just knew that buyers would come in to support and defend this area. We talked about the reasons why, so go listen to yesterday's show and you'll get caught up on that. Then it becomes, all right, if they're going to take it this high, how high are they going to take it? We're always building legs in one direction or another. Leg and retrace, leg and retrace, leg and retrace, right? Transition, leg, and a retrace, okay? All right, if you watched the end of yesterday's show, if you weren't here yesterday, it will all start to make sense to you, okay? Talked about it in great detail right at the end of the show, and we're coming down good. Now, this is last week's weekly trading zone. These are all last week's zones. It was 80, it was 76, 77. There you go. Double check. I believe that was it. Yep. That was our lowest weekly zone last week. And so this week we've been just oscillating. And we finally broke away from this zone to get turned right back down. Okay. All right. Good word for the day. Are you struggling financially? That's a question. These things dominate the thoughts of unbelievers, but your Heavenly Father already knows all your needs. Matthew 6:32. Focus on the part. Your Heavenly Father already knows all of your needs. Donna Savage writes, in my husband's first year as a pastor, our mortgage payment gobbled up half of his income. I learned to replace panic with peace by praying for clarity. Money is linked to our self-esteem. If you don't believe me, ask Donald Trump. It can trigger feelings of shame, fear, pride, and anger. But understanding God's word brings light to the minds of ordinary people, people like us. Psalm 119 through 130. Now, here's the focus. Clarity, and then creativity. If you want more money, you've got to either earn more or spend less. I know that seems overly simplistic, but I'll say it again. If you want more money, you must earn more or spend less. We serve a creative God, and he rewards those who diligently seek him. Hebrews 11:6. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Ask him to show you how to increase your income. Connections. Kids are familiar with connect the dot puzzles, where you join a random collection of dots to produce an image that you'd otherwise not be able to see. So in life, as we grow up, it's still all about the right connections, connecting the dots. God can send the right people into your life, people with answers to your money problems. Contentment. Just like earthquakes expose structural weaknesses in buildings, financial pressure exposes our spiritual weakness. Paul said, I have learned the secret of being content. In Philippians 4:12, Paul said, I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I've learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. Key phrase, I have learned. Hardship enrolls us all in a basic contentment course. But we don't all get the same homework. Some of us learn through financial hardship and proving God's faithfulness for ourselves. Donna Savage continues, I've given God, and I can't do this ultimatum more than once. I've also celebrated the adventure of moment by moment dependence on his resources. I've proved God's faithfulness in my prayers and in my pantry. And it's never limited by my bank balance. So if you are struggling financially, take that to heart. In particular, read Philippians 4:12, Hebrews 11:6, because that's a really good word for the day. All right, let's go to the chart. Much time we got? We got just a couple minutes, so we'll take a look at a couple of markets. We'll talk to David. After we talk to David, we'll talk to Jim. Jim's here today. Okay, S&P 500. Last night on the S&P, here, let's use this one. There we go. Okay, last night, I gotta bring that up again. Well, I'm going to burn up all my time just getting logged in again. That's all right. As soon as we're done talking to David, we'll go over it then. Okay, the S&P last night, Concierge Trade Alert, went out early last night. Got them out at 7:40 p.m. Eastern. Now, we were looking to be long above 1908. Swing high was 07. And we're looking to be short below 1870. Haven't got there yet. Now, we did send out a little alert in the middle of the night that said, if we get below 83, we'll go ahead and take advantage of that. Okay? It's a new dawn. It's a new day. And there's one trade for the day. So I'll put a little mark here, 1883. And we'll see if through the course of the program we stumble into that. Can we? There we go. 83. Okay. All right, it's top of the hour, so we're going to go to Vegas, talk to David. When we're done, Jim, White Bar Jim, should be joining us at 1:30 Eastern. We'll come back. We'll take a look at bonds, crude oil, the euro, soybeans, the Dow, the Russell, and gold. We'll take a look at each and every one of those. So stand by. Don't go away. Some days things just all work and some days they don't.
You're listening to CFRN, a community of believers who trade for a living. To learn more about who we are, what we do, and how we do it, call toll-free 1-866-928-3310, and we'll send you out a no-obligation information kit absolutely free. 866-928-3310.
Good morning, Dwayne.
Good morning, David. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. Real pleasure to be here. Hope everyone's having a, well, at least a pretty good day.
It's awesome.
That's what I'm hoping.
Awesome. Awesome all over the land. What's up with you?
Well, nothing really that new. We're keeping an eye on the markets, of course. You know, getting interesting indications here from the S&P and some of the other markets. We're keeping an eye on, you know, the news. We're not news traders, of course, but I'm interested in the news from time to time about some of the shifts that are taking place. And we don't have to go into this right now, but just I think it's interesting that what is happening with Vladimir Putin and his desire to take on ISIS in order to then pretty much probably control Syria at that point. He's a very crafty and very focused leader. He has a great deal of leadership qualities for his country. He may be doing bad things, and he certainly is not a good actor, good player, but he certainly has focus and leadership qualities that I think he could pass some of those out for our current administration, which just, you know, does nothing about any of this stuff, and that's part of the reason we have these problems. So it's like we've talked about before, if a person were to take a successful company that's underway, like as an example, an Amazon or a Google or, you know, name your favorite company, whatever it is, somebody's running that company. Somebody's making day-to-day, moment-by-moment decisions about the future plans for that company, the intermediate plans, the stuff that has to get done now. If you put somebody of lesser vision, lesser leadership qualities and so on into that company, almost immediately there is a change in the company. And as time passes, if that person doesn't have that leadership and that vision and so on, things start to go awry. The company isn't doing so well. Projects aren't happening the way they should. People aren't responding like they used to the products, and one thing after another, and before you know it, you've got serious problems. That's the kind of thing that happens to the United States, too, when we don't have really good and even great leadership. The President of the United States is supposed to have great leadership qualities. That's who we're supposed to have in the White House. We're supposed to have somebody with great leadership qualities. He's the President of the United States. And because we don't have that, and because so many things were left just untouched and undone, and bad moves were made, poor decisions were made based on ideology, we have this entire Mideast just blowing up. You know, power. You leave a power vacuum open, and what do you think is going to happen? Of course, people are going to come in and take that over. And that's what happened in Iraq, and we all know the story. So suddenly now a whole new thing has emerged where Vladimir Putin is essentially taking the job over to go kick the butt of ISIS. And, you know, Russia doesn't have exactly the very best military. I mean, they're very tough, but they're certainly not anywhere near the best military in the world. But they're very tough and they're very ruthless and they're willing to get the job done. There's no political correctness there. They're going to go in and do what needs to be done to get that job done if they're going to go after ISIS. And it's just shifts. This is a major shift in the whole outlook of what's going to happen with ISIS and what's going to happen with Syria, if any of that is of interest to anyone. And I just found it very interesting that I think that's going to be the handoff. We're going to hand off Syria to Russia, and we're going to basically the price of that is that Russia will, you know, Putin will basically control Syria. So in the end, if he does the job and he cleans out ISIS and you know, really does a good job, he's going to be in command of Syria. So he's very strategic, he's very bright, and he really knows what he wants. He's a realist, and he's looking at what he can really get done, as opposed to our administration, which is looking to avoid doing things and avoid being called out on anything. I mean, a very, very big difference. I'm not saying Putin is a good guy or a good actor, a good player, but he is focused. He does have the skills of a great leader, And even though he's maybe doing bad things with those, he does have those skills, and he's now in a position after doing Crimea and all these other things that he's pulled off, he's now going to pull off probably the Syrian thing. And it's just an amazing thing what's been happening if you think about the Mideast and what's been going on out there. All of it will ultimately affect the United States in one way or the other, but it can't come soon enough that we get leadership in the United States. We can't, it couldn't come any sooner than next year. I think we all know that. So that's all. Just an interesting thing. It's a big shift from where we are now. Putin came out here, and we'll see how this plays out over the next year or so, with him taking control of the job of taking out ISIS. So we'll see.
Now, his parliament gave him unanimous backing to go in and do this.
Oh, absolutely. They know what the game is.
Moscow gave Washington just 1 hour's notice. We're going in. And within an hour, they were there.
Yeah. That's a big deal. It's a big shift. It's a big change. And, you know, nobody over here said, hey, no, don't do that, you know. And that's okay. You know, if he wants to go in and do that, and, you know, he's willing to basically, he's doing it to get control of Syria. That's what
now back to the part about him, you know, about them not having the greatest military. Targets in the Homs area appear to have been struck. Unfortunately, not any areas that are actually held by the Islamic State.
Right.
Now, that bit of press, of course, was put out by a U.S. official. So we'll have to wait, and we'll get some independent input from not the Associated Press out of Washington, but perhaps The Guardian out of the UK, which may tell a little different story.
Sure. So this is going to be part of the news cycle for quite some time now, his work to find these guys. And, you know, I'd give him a little time to go figure out where they are, what they need to do, and all that stuff. But it's a big deal, you know, the whole thing. I thought, anyway.
The last time the Russian parliament granted Putin the right to deploy troops abroad, a technical requirement under Russian law, Moscow seized Crimea from Ukraine. That was last year. He has to have parliament's backing to ensure that any military operation is legal under the terms of the Russian Constitution. Now, you know, for kids growing up today, it's a very different Russia than we grew up with, USSR, Cold War, you know, bomb raids, hiding under your desk, all that stuff. You know, that was the Cold War. Who's going to pull the trigger first? It was a very nerve-wracking time for many people. Bomb shelters were built in backyards, all sorts of things. Our kids today have grown up with a Russia that, well, while we're not best buds and in love with each other, there hasn't been any antagonism, so to speak. So Russia may no longer be the USSR, but there's still Russia. And America would do well not to forget that. On Facebook and just floating all around social media yesterday was a montage of pictures that shows Putin meeting all these different world leaders, looking them in the eye, and right beside it would be our president bowing to the same world leader. Putin looks him in the eye, our president bows. So pictures worth a thousand words. So
I don't know where the bowing thing even started. Where does that come from? Why is bowing our president's thing to do? Why is he not shaking the hand? What's the bow all about? Is that a Middle Eastern, that's the Middle Eastern handshake is the bow, and that's what he does? Something. I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, when he was first elected and went on the apology tour, He went straight to Saudi Arabia, and that was his first bow, I believe. He bowed to the Saudi king, and it's just that's his way. It's how he rolls. So anyway,
here we are.
All right, so you want to talk about the S&P?
Sure, let's talk about the S&P.
Well,
we yesterday the market did complete a number of important indications. I had mentioned on the program yesterday that daily close above 1868 would be a stronger position for a multi-day advance. We did close above 1868 yesterday, and we had forecast that the market would test 1904 to 1905. Today's session high was 1907, so they did test and complete those levels. Although this wasn't an absolute forecast, I had indicated in both of our meetings this morning that I have a preference for the market, and I think it probably would follow through with this because we have a larger forecast that this is all fitting within. But I had a preference that the market would go down, take out today's low, today's actual pit session low, which was 1894.50. It would take that out on the way down from 1904 and go test 1890 and then 1890 and then 1887. And we've seen both of those levels. Now, these were not outright forecasts for trading purposes, but I felt that the market should do that under just the premise that it wants to flush people out of the market, and that would be the kind of move that it would do to do that. And we did indeed get down to 1887. We got down to 1886.50, and we're seeing the market firm up on that level. I'm happy to see that. I think I can't give you out the numbers here on the program, but I can tell you that I think it's, with a little more confirmation, I think substantially higher prices are potentially indicated here based on today's action so far. For me, I want to make sure that I want to have a little further confirmation of that before I'm willing to take less money and have more certainty. And that's what I'm going to do in putting this trade together on the long side here. So we'll see how they treat the 1887 level and so on. And I'm looking forward to potentially having a very nice S&P trade on the long side. And if they, I think it goes without saying, if the market, one way or the other, somehow gets back below 1868, 1867, especially closing below, that would be a very weak position for the market to be in at that time. I don't expect that. I'm not forecasting that. I don't expect it either. I think that what we did today with the 1887 on the downside, I think that's a pretty good move down for them to bounce here from. And I wouldn't be surprised at all to see them bounce off that, get back up to, into the mid-90s or higher from that bounce this morning. So, that's our take on the S&P. And again, we're basing that on a combination, just like many people do. They use your technical analysis, but then you also might include in that some other observations. You can't discount experience, and experience plays its part, and experience also comes from trading and losing, not just trading and making money. I think you have to be around, you have to go through that process. It would be nice if it wasn't that way, that people didn't have to, but I think most of us do have to go through that process. Whatever the number isn't important, but it has to be a sustained period where you're struggling with the markets. Part of that period is the reason I think that's the case. It's factual that most people do. In a year I talk to an awful lot of traders. Obviously, we interact with a lot of people all over the world. We have a worldwide audience for our work and so on. The majority of these people have all gone through this. Some of them have not because they're newer to it, but a lot have that have gone around. And until you do go through that, there are some lessons that are not burned in your brain and experiences, which adds up to experience that you need to learn how to do the right thing and not get trapped in the market, in a wrong position, bad position, holding on to losing positions, and so on. So it'd be nice if it didn't have to be that way, but it's like life. You just can't absolutely protect. It's like saying, you know, I have a program so that I can have my son or daughter go to school and never have their feelings hurt, never have someone else tell them they're ugly or make fun of them. You know, you can't do it. It's not possible. You know, they're going to go through that situation. They're going to have to live through that and get through that on their own. It's just the same thing with trading, I think. So there is experience, and while you're going through that period, you don't see the value of it, but over time it adds up to experience, and you can tell when you're talking with somebody who really, really, truly hasn't done that yet. They make comments, they make statements, they have questions that illustrate that they really, in fact, have not really gone through, for them, what the big, the really big drawdown was.
And
really
your heart breaks for them because you know where they're headed, you know what's coming, and you don't want to rain on anybody's parade, but shame on you if you don't give them some level of understanding and fair warning and just encourage them to go slow, take it easy, trade small. Okay. Your learning curve can have a lot of commas in it or a few. It's, you know, the old go big or go home thing. That does not apply to trading. Okay. Not when you're first starting, not when you're trying to learn. And when somebody says something like, oh, well, and I'm not like some new kid on the block, I've been at this for 6 months. Oh, I'm sorry. I misspoke. 6 months. I had no idea. Okay. Well, you should need to come over on this side of the desk. Come on. So, yeah, just be careful.
And
I don't mean that, you know, pedantically to anyone. I say it out of genuine concern. Because when somebody tells me, hey, I figured out how to make 2 points a day, and so you've got a clever little thing you do where you step it up one contract at a time, and I appreciate you trying to protect people, but I'm a smart guy, and I have some money, and so I'm just going to go ahead and trade 20 contracts because I know that the S&P has the volume to handle that. Mm-hmm. Why has that never once ended well? And I, too, talk to a lot of traders every day. We, too, have a global audience for our work. Why has that never once ended well? Any ideas?
You're saying to me?
Yeah.
Because it has to happen. That's why. Because people have to learn it. They have to go through it themselves. And like I said, it becomes pretty obvious when you're speaking with people. If that hasn't been an experience of theirs yet, that just by the way they talk about the markets, the questions they ask, and so on, it's not something that anyone would ever want to brag about, that they, how much, although I've run into people who brag how much they've lost. It's a strange thing to do, but you have to go through it just like you do in other areas in order to get through and build the experience base and have some insight. And most people, because trading is it is a skill. It's something that has to be practiced, and you have to really dial down your focus and so on and understand what you're doing. Because it requires all that, most people do. I mean, I certainly went through a horrific period of that. I think a lot of people do, especially if you're coming from any other area that you may – this is very common. People that are successful in some other area in their life, they feel that, you know, they have the Midas touch. They come to the markets with that same feeling, and mm-hmm. why not? And then they find out that the Midas touch doesn't carry over to this. It's very rare that somebody has the Midas touch for markets. Most people who can do this well have done it well or are doing it well through years and years and even sometimes decades of practice and experience to get to the level that where they can actually do it well and have a be able to use it as a source of income and so on. Now there's there are people who can learn faster. Some of us are slower than others. Some of us are more, maybe there's a there's other factors involved, but it can be done by anyone. Just a matter of the desire and the willingness to go through the work and to question your own perceptions, because as we've said before, everyone has a method, everyone has some way of doing it, but we all have a certain way of looking at the markets. We have a way of processing that information, and that is your particular way of looking at it. I have found that it's very important to learn how to shake yourself out of that, your own way of looking at it, which you can't see unless you're forced to. You know, your natural way of looking at things isn't obvious to you, the viewer. It isn't obvious to you. But it is obvious if you do certain things, you can actually force yourself to see it in a different way. And I do that myself, and I've learned over years of doing this that that is a very useful practice, because it keeps you, it allows you to see things that you wouldn't ordinarily see. And because again, however you naturally see things, there's nothing wrong with that, but it's the only way that you will see things. And so there's things you can do, I won't go into all of it right now, that can actually help you to see things other ways. And that helps you to realize that a great deal of trading success has to do with perception and what you can and can't see. We're all going to see the same actual chart in front of us, but we all don't see the same patterns. We all don't see the same price bars because we're processing that information differently. If I pointed out something, in fact, I'm going to be pointing things out to a room full of people here soon, October 10th and 11th here, coming up at the Mirage, and we have a seminar on the Square Principle. And I can assure you I'm going to show them some things that anyone could see, but we're going to spend that first hour with a group of very bright people just getting that one thing into their mind, just making sure that everyone sees the exact thing that I'm showing, and everyone won't. Everyone will not see it, even though the first hour I'll be speaking about it. I will get questions, and this is fine. This is part of the process. This is part of the proof that that's there, is that people will still struggle with it and ask questions about it because they're perceiving things quite differently, useful to them, useful possibly to others, but in trying to teach them something, you find out where people's limitations are, their little corners and turns in their head in the way they perceive things. So
there's a TED talk that deals specifically with that. Are you familiar with TED Talks?
I have not heard one. I think I've heard you mention this on your program, or you have some link to it or something.
Yeah, you should Google it up sometime.
Sure.
Some really fascinating and incredibly intelligent people spend 5, 10, 15 minutes on stage presenting a thought, a concept, an idea. One I watched the other day had to do with how easily the eye is fooled by what you think you're going to see, or what you've trained yourself to see. These filters are built in, and so he would show you something and you wouldn't see it. But then once he highlighted it and showed it to you, then you could not see it.
Right.
So first you could not see it, and then once he showed it to you, then you could not see it.
Yeah. So all of this is part of the thing of trading, is that there's an awful lot of stuff in front of us, and people see things differently in front of them. And occasionally you'll get somebody who generally sees it as you do, and sometimes you'll run into somebody who sees it completely differently, and they're struggling and they're looking at other parts of the chart. You're pointing out something over here, but they're looking over there, and you say, well, why are you looking over there? Well, I just wanted to see if that, and that's connecting something up for them in their own mind. They need to look somewhere else, and that's distorting what you're saying to them. And so this is not something to be afraid of. This is just something to be aware that everyone isn't seeing the same chart. I can assure you that you put a chart up and everyone is not seeing the same chart. Everyone is not thinking about, some people are emphasizing and de-emphasizing other things that are in front of them and constantly doing that.
Now,
and we are as well.
The same guy played a couple of albums backwards. Remember the old play the album backwards and get the secret message? Mm-hmm. Stairway to Heaven, the first minute of it, if you play it backwards the first time around, you can hear Satan a couple of times. I mean, that just really, you can hear it. But that's it. I mean, Now, the second time he plays it backwards, exact same sound file, up on the screen, he shows you a series of words. And my goodness, it's amazing what your ears hear now that your eyes are reading it. Man, you hear it clear as a bell. It's not just Satan being randomly said a couple times. I mean, it's still a little bit of nonsense, but it's amazing how you hear those words so clearly now. TED Talks, gosh, I don't even know what the name of it would be. Probably Illusion. If you Google TED Talks and Illusions, probably it will come up somewhere in that category. Very interesting. I encourage you. Yeah.
Well, many years ago, there was a guy, and we'll just talk about this a minute, and then we'll finish up on Marcus, but there was a fellow that was espousing that when people spoke, a politician or anybody spoke, that the truth of what they were saying was actually hidden in their words but could only be heard if you played it backwards. So this was a play on the play it backwards thing. And I forgot what it's called, but it's reverse something. And it was finally debunked after several years of people doing it, because the way that he would present it would be, he would say, here's the politician talking forwards, and the politician is stating, I'm going to, you know, lower taxes, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. And then he would say to you, now here's what he's saying backwards, I'm going to play it backwards, and he's telling you, I'll raise taxes and I'm going to, you know, help the rich. And so he plays the thing backwards, let's just say, you know, he plays the thing backwards, and lo and behold, you can kind of hear in there, I'll raise taxes. It's more like, oh, I'll raise taxes and help the rich. You know, you hear something like that, like I'm sort of imitating how it might sound. And the nonsense of it is that if you don't tell people in advance what to listen for, no one hears anything.
Exactly, yeah.
They play
yeah.
it backwards. But if you tell them, here's what, and so he's listened to it backwards, and he's going to make up the closest
hey,
words.
Hey, David, can you keep talking, and I'll be right back in just a second.
Yeah, absolutely. He's going to make up the closest words he can. He's played it backwards. He's trying to figure out the best thing he can associate that with. But to a person who has not heard it at all, they don't hear that. But if you tell that person, here's what he is going to say backwards, they do hear it, and that debunks it. Because people should be able to hear it on their own without the suggestion of what the words are, and our brain finishes the sentence, finishes the words, and so on, and fills in all the little blanks. So that lasted for a while. Anyway, all of this happens in the market with perception. It's not anything that you have to worry about, but it is something that I think is very valuable to force yourself to see things differently, and I have a number of ways that I do that. Because I know that I can't help but see things the way that I see them. So I have to force it in other ways. And we can have that discussion sometimes. As we were talking, the S&P did get up. I was talking about 95, 96, and so on. They just rallied up there as we were speaking here. That would be the normal little intraday bounce that we would expect off of the completion of that level at 1886.50 or 1887 that we talked about before. Bigger picture, I just want to say again, although we are not fully confirmed on this, there is a wild card, something we call a wild card, which is where we have a lot of different things coming together, but the indication may not have been fully confirmed in the way that we like to see it confirmed as yet. And that wild card could have the market substantially higher coming into Friday, plus or minus a day. So that's something we're working on right now with the S&P. I think it's a pretty interesting set of conditions that we have in the markets right now, and I'm hoping to be able to put that together over today and tomorrow, because tomorrow is Thursday. Let me see if there's anything else while we're waiting for Duane to return.
No, I'm here. Today's the end of the month, by the way.
Yeah, today ends the month. Tomorrow's October 1st. And so we have pretty much ripped through the majority of another year, the year of 2015. And, you know, longer term, we've talked about this, our outlook is for the market to put in a top for a multi-year decline, multi-year sideways to lower decline. So we're waiting on that further confirmation, and that's in spite of any advance, even one that we're talking about now, with the possibility of substantially higher prices and all that.
Question, what do you got on gold?
Well, it's interesting. Let's talk a little bit about gold. Gold did break below a kind of important level, certainly for us, an important level between, I think, 29 and 24, and we're now inching in on another critical juncture. So this is really important because markets will tend to try to flush out participants who are on the right side of the move prior to giving them a really larger move. And gold may be doing that here because this is a somewhat unusual position for gold right here. It's not terribly unusual, but it's somewhat. And that means that there's a real opportunity here when the markets get to these critical junctures. So one thing I would say is that October 1st is an important, those of you that have reflected wave know that October 1st is an important daily bottom. And, you know, we've got some other indications with it. So we're very interested in how gold handles itself. Probably not going to do anything with it until tomorrow, but we are interested in it here as the market has sold off decently here from the 24 level. So that's what we're looking for. We're waiting into tomorrow before we take action. I've said this many times, listen, I'd rather make less money with more certainty. I may make less, or our approach may make less than you on a given trade or another trader on a given trade, but over time, because of the consistency, and many of you have seen that, of the forecasts and the completions and so on, that's going to put the person who's making less money with more certainty well ahead of the person who is maybe making more money on an individual trade in the abstract, but with a lot less certainty, and therefore he has more losses that he has to make up. And that's a big part of trading is how, you know, if you have a $100 and you lose 10%, you now have $90. And you have to make up more than 10% to get, you have to make up about 11% of that to get back to even. If you lose 20%, you don't have to make up 20%, you have to make up 25% in order of your money, your $80. You have to make 25% now of $80 to get back to where you started, which is $100. So you can say, well, I'm only down 20%. No, you're down 25%. Even though it's 20% of 100, you no longer have 100. You have 80.
That's right.
So you're down 25%. You need to make 25% of $80 in order to get up back to 100. Most people don't think about this.
Well, after a while, it starts to sink in, I think, because it's that fear that grips them when they sit down to put on their first trade of the day and get stopped out. It's like, I need ball. There's no way I'm going to pull out of this. Just, you know, the whole negative self-talk, the 8-track starts to spin upstairs. And, yeah, because it's tough unless you have a plan, unless you know how you're going to deal with that, unless you know how you're going to overcome that. A couple questions, one on bonds. See, Don says, yesterday I asked if David had any comments on bonds and crude, and then Ed's got a question for you on the S&P. So what do you want to talk about?
Okay, well, let's take a quick look at the bonds. I do like some of the things that I'm seeing in the bonds right now with regard to our ability to make a call and forecast where our next trade is going to be. I am not quite ready to put that out yet, and I said this to people today. But it's very interesting, and I like what I'm seeing on the pullback today. So this is not a today trade. If we're going to do something, we may, for our group, we may put it out later today. I kind of doubt that. I think it's probably going to lead us into tomorrow. There's a lot of stuff leading into October 2nd plus or minus a day, right in that time frame, there's a lot of indications, and I think I want to let the market act that out a little bit more before we jump on a trade for that. With regard to crude oil, those of you that might be in our group, we are now looking at crude oil more intraday. Most of the indications we've given out for crude are, you know, daily or three-day chart and that kind of thing. We're looking for, you know, the bigger moves. But there is enough volatility, not just recently, but, you know, in the bigger picture, there's enough volatility to really have some great intraday calls. I mean, strictly built upon the intraday indication in crude. So we're watching those. We're setting those up now to see if we can put to use the same kind of information that we do in crude on the daily, but on the shorter term charts, which is not what we've done in the past. We've done larger term stuff in that market, and I think there's already a decent amount of evidence that we can, you know, the question is, does on a shorter term time frame, can we understand the theoretical, you know, the not yet expressed theoretical power and where it's going to get expressed? Like, as an example, in today's session, this was something that just Jerry and I were talking about, but I mentioned it in our group that the gold, that the crude, which was trading at $45.50, we felt if we were correct, there should be a minor wave down to $45.10. So it's not big, it's 40 cents or something, but they did do that in the last hour, and that tells me that the market is, at the very least, expressing the theoretical wave properly, that it is, direction was down, the price level was such and such, and so I'm very excited about that, and that we may be able to tie those two together, something we've not done in the past with crude oil. Crude oil has always been a daily, three-day, weekly, and so on type of chart for us. So that's all I can tell you right now, but you can always sign up for a trial and take a look at what we're doing with it. I'd be very happy to demonstrate as soon as we have that good enough for showtime, so to speak. With regard to so bonds, yeah, that was bonds and crude. And somebody, did somebody say something about the S&P, or because we've already covered the S&P?
Ed W. asked, on the S&P, would a daily close below 1887 negate your upside outlook, or would it take the close below 1867 to negate
the upside? It would take the close below 1867.
Okay.
So when the market broke the other day and it got below 1897, we had said that the market will run to 1868, 1867, and if they close above those levels, that will be a buy. And we did spike those levels. We got down to 1861, but we closed above 67, and we're there's a possibility, as I've said before, for an explosive move out of this area. We're not quite ready to confirm that just yet, but I, so far, I like everything that I've seen. Today's decline intraday off the high of the completion of 1905, the decline to 1887. I mean, the market is acting wonderfully today, very easy to read, and acting very well in accordance to our method. So I think the most important thing is that there's the potential for an explosive move up, and I wouldn't take that information and do anything with it yet. We're not doing anything with it yet. We're waiting for a little more confirmation. So I hope that's...
Hey, anything on the euro?
We're flat on the euro right now, and I know you have your guest probably waiting here, Dwayne, and I've got about 4 minutes here. So
yeah, Jim's with us, and I'll open up your mic, Jim. Stand by. You go ahead with what you were saying, Dave.
Well, just that I think there's a lot of indications here. As I said, coming into October 2nd, plus or minus a day, there's a lot of stuff for us, and we're waiting. We want to see the markets confirm for that. There's plenty of room in all these trades to take advantage of it. What I was saying earlier, just briefly, was that I wanted to finish that thought, just that, you know, over the long haul, if you make less money with more certainty, you're going to be ahead of somebody who's making more money in the abstract but with less certainty, because that less certainty, it's a debt that has to be paid. That those are, you know, those are losses that will have to be made up, and every time a loss has to be made up, someone who's trading with more certainty is going to be getting ahead. He's making less money with more certainty, but he's getting ahead. It's not a race between you and anyone else. It's just what is better. You know, what, which way is better? Would you, you know, I would rather, you know, it's like saying I'd rather not be in a relationship than be in a bad one. Well, I'd rather not be in a trade than be in a bad one. I'd like to only be, as best as I can, only in good trades that have real good indications around them and that I'm enthusiastic to be in. rather than being, and the price for that is that I'm going to miss some good trades. I'm going to wait and I'm going to miss some good trades, but I also therefore don't have to be, I'd rather miss some good trades than participate in some bad ones. How's that? I'd rather miss some good ones. That happens occasionally. You're going to miss some good ones.
So you're not wearing the t-shirt that says it is better to have traded and been stopped out than to have never traded at all.
I don't wear that t-shirt, gotcha. But I think anybody who trades will have to be stopped out at some point. I don't think you can call yourself a trader if you haven't traded.
That's a fact. If you don't use a stop, you're not a trader, period.
Yeah. That is right.
I don't even think you're a gambler. I think you're just you just haven't learned. You just haven't learned yet that you have to.
Good morning, James. So. Jim.
Hey,
David.
Jim.
How are you today?
What's up, buddy?
Hey, what's going on, Dwayne? Hi, guys. How are you?
Good.
So you've got a seminar coming up at the Mirage out in Vegas, David?
I do, yes. On the 10th and 11th of October, we're going to be teaching what we call the Square Principle. And a lot of the work that we do is based upon that. It's one of those things that people can look at charts, but they won't see it until it's shown to them. And once you can see it, you can actually define pretty much all market movement by that principle. You can say this is what it's doing, kind of like how an Elliott wave or other kind of thing tries to encompass, you know, I wasn't trying to encompass the whole, it wasn't supposed to be the unified field theory for, you know, markets, but it worked out that you can really say describe a lot of market movement relative to the square, and it's such an important part of what we do that I think it's time to teach it. So we're doing that.
Very good. Well, I wish you luck with the seminar, and hopefully you'll have a sold-out room, and you'll educate a lot of people.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate that, and I'll let you get on to your
Richard, I had a final question there for you. David, do you see the August 24th lows being taken out in October?
I don't have a forecast for that at this point. Later I may have a forecast for that, but now at this point I don't. We're really focusing on this larger potential move up that we're talking about, this explosive move that we want to see more confirmation for. Once that happens, we may have some other things, and I appreciate the question. It's a good one, but I'm not quite there yet. So we'll let that go for the time being. And Jim, have a wonderful morning here on the radio. Dwayne, I'll see you tomorrow.
Jim or David, take care.
Thanks very much. See you guys.
Have a good day, David. Bye. Take care.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
So, Jim, what's going on?
Not a whole lot. How are you today?
Pretty good, man.
Good.
Pretty good.
Well, did you make some good trades in the last week?
Yeah. No, we've done quite well. How about you?
I've done good. I'm in that area of 20 to 30 ticks, so I have no complaints there.
Want to walk us through some charts?
Yeah, if you want to send the charts over, I will show you what I did on the Russell and on the crude chart today.
All right. There you go. Should be coming your way.
Let me know when you can see my screen.
I got it.
Okay, this is
loud and clear.
Hang on a second. All right, this is the Russell and opening bell here, 8:30. And we're doing it through the white bar trades. This is a weekly trading zone. This is just an area that I put in later in the day, trading day, but that'll probably come up here at some point. So our first trade, we were in the middle of a weekly trading zone. We had a white bar that up closed at 8:34. I went long on that. I was able to get 6 ticks out of that. Got taken out on a pullback. However, it did run for quite a few ticks more. But on the pullback, like I said, I got taken out of that trade. Next white bar is a double white bar, so we don't trade that. Followed by another double white bar, skip that one. Then the next one comes in at 8:42, followed by a down close. Went short on the down close. I locked in 3 ticks and got taken out of that one again on the pullback. You can see it pulled back almost back to break even again, and then it went south nicely. So two trades, nine ticks there. Next single white bar comes in, and you can see we're kind of hanging around the zone. We're below it, we're in it, we're above it, we're back below it. So let's see. Next white bar comes in at 8:47, closes up right into the weekly trading zone. Went long on that one, locked in three ticks on that one. Again, got taken out with the pullback. That one only offered five ticks, but I got three of those out of that trade. Then we come down to a double white bar, so we skip that trade. I missed this next one. I was probably doing something in the crude market, but I missed that trade there. And that would have been a nice one. That closed up at 1090.4 and went all the way up to 1092.2. So that would have been a nice one, but unfortunately missed that. Next one is a white bar in the zone. Closes down. Got two ticks out of that one. It offered five. I got two of them on a pullback again. So let's see. This next set of trades, I missed these trades here. This would have been a down close. I'd have dumped that one with a two-tick loss. And the next one was a double white bar, so I would have traded that anyway. All right, next single white bar comes in for me down at 8:59, so we're at the top of the hour. Closes up. Locked in three ticks, and it took me out on a pullback again. That one did offer up offered up nine ticks. I took three of that one. Next is a double white bar. We don't trade the double white bars. Next white bar, a red candle, but it closes up. So I went long on the up close, locked in three ticks on that one. Then I got a bunch of white bars, so this is getting a little congested here, but took three ticks out of that trade. This single white bar here is followed by a G. We don't trade the dojis. Next white bar closes up, locked in four ticks on that trade. It ran 11 ticks. I got four of them on a pullback on this bar here. So we move on, back up above the weekly trading zone again. Two white bars, don't trade it. Two white bars, don't trade it. Three, four white bars, don't trade it. Next single white bar comes in at 9:27, closes up. After break even, I locked in four ticks. It offered five, so I was able to get four ticks out of it. And that bar actually set the high of the day, which is where we're currently at. So it's four ticks on that trade. Next is multiple white bars here. Then we have white bars and a single white bar. I missed this one. This is right when the inventory trades came out, so I was probably watching the crude oil inventory. Mm-hmm. I don't trade the inventory trades, but we'll go to crude next after we finish up here on the Russell. So I didn't take either of these trades here. Okay, next white bar here is at 8:41. It closes up. Locked in three ticks, got taken out on a pullback. That one offered five. I got three of them out of that one. The next white bar closed up, and it was followed by a white bar that closed down. So I went long, and then on the close of the white bar, I dumped the trade. That goes against my rules, so I dumped that with a two-tick loss on that particular trade. And we have double white bars, don't trade. Double white bars, don't trade. Next single white bar comes in at 9:50, closes down. Locked in five ticks on that. It offered, looks like eight ticks. I have five of those. Next white bar comes in at 10:04. It was a down close. That one was a full eight tick stop out on that one. Minus eight there, going back up into the zone. Next single white bar is an up close in the zone. And that one closes at 10:15. And I went short on that one. Then the next white bar, it was followed by another white bar that closed up against me, so I dumped that trade also for a three tick loss on that. And that would have taken me to the end of trading on that particular market. So all of that came out to 13 trades with 23 ticks on the Russell today. There was one full 8-tick stop out, one stop out for 3 ticks, and one stop out for 2 ticks. So 23 positive ticks on that particular market.
Nice day.
Yeah, it was a good day on the Russell. So let's take a look at the crude now. Back this thing up to 8:30. Where are you? There you are. Oh, great. Now watch this not color up for us. I hate when that happens because it may take a while. Well, see if we get some color here.
All the way to the right, do you have color there?
Yeah. Let's go back and see where it comes in at. Well, there we go. We're going to get some of them anyway. Little by little. Okay, here we go. Okay, so 8:30 opens here. Didn't get this first trade. And we got starts going up. We get a single white bar here with an up close. Now, this second white bar that followed, it closed in the same direction of the trade, so you don't dump your trade there. So I stayed into this trade, locked in 7 ticks, came back and took me out on this particular bar here. It did continue going up. That, if you just stayed back on that one, you could have made made your whole week on that particular trade. But I got 7 ticks on that trade. Let's see. White bar here, double white bar here, double white bar here. Start back down. This orange line here is 9:30. This is when the inventory trades came out, and I don't trade the inventory trades. I usually wait till 9:40 to 9:45. Now, when the inventory trades got locked into this area here, I went ahead and I put a box in just to show that was an area that attraction to, and that comes back into play later in the day, actually. Okay. So where are we at here? Up to 9. Okay, so here's the orange line. This takes me up to 9:45, so now I'll go ahead and start trading the crude oil market again. So we're at 9:46. We get a white bar with a down close. Lock in 6 ticks on that one. It gets stuck here a little bit at this support resistance level. Took me out with 6 ticks and then went south some more, but 6 ticks on that trade. We get a double white bar here, a double white bar here, so we don't trade those. I missed these two trades. I was probably in something in the Russell at that time. Double white bar here. Single white bar here closes down. 4 ticks profit. I went to break even. I locked in 2 and it took me out with 2 ticks on that particular trade. This trade here, this is at 9:56. Closes down. 4 ticks profit. Went to break even. Went to the next level. Locked in 3 and got taken out of that on a pullback. So those two trades netted 5 ticks. We've got a double white bar here. A single white bar here at 10:02 closes down. Got 7 ticks out of that trade. Okay, we have a single white bar here, but it's followed by a doji, so we don't trade that. Single white bar here closes down. It went the wrong way on me. Now, this white bar closed up, but it was still an 8 tick stop out on that particular trade, so I lost 8 ticks on that that trade there. Missed this, missed this. Double white bar here. Then we have a single white bar here. And you can see this is that area from the inventory trades where price was drawn to. It's almost acting like a weekly trading zone there. White bar here, 10:24 closes up. Offered 5 ticks. I took 3 of those. And then the last one I traded was an up close at 10:27. And this one offered 13 ticks, and I was able to get 5 of that. So on the crude, how many trades is that? 8 trades on crude, and I had 1 8 tick stop out and positive 25 ticks. So I've got 25 ticks on crude today, 23 ticks on the Russell for a total of 48 ticks today. I'm going to sneeze. Hold on a second, Dwayne. I hope I got that muted quick enough.
Yeah, we could have lived through it.
Oh, that's okay. Okay, so those are the only two markets that I traded today. I didn't do anything on any of the other markets. Does anybody have any questions about the white bars, entries, exits, stops, anything like that I can try to help you with?
Yeah, I'm typing in an answer right now. I've answered... Okay. The last one I answered, Casey said, I am totally confused why you present such a different trading method to what Michael presents in my live trading room. Okay. Casey, the tool has been in our toolbox since the beginning. This is the CFTC, okay, which is the Trend Change Indicator, CFTC. we encourage our partners to take the tools in the toolbox. We only use two trade setups and two indicators in the live trading room. We have about 10 tools in the toolbox. We highly encourage our traders, once they become consistently profitable, we can encourage them to go into the toolbox and create something of their own design which has their DNA, something that they own, something that will allow them to never have to look back again. Okay? What we do in the live trading room every day is designed to get you up and running and profitable. If you choose to simply stay with that, bullish cross, price pulls away, price pulls back, up close, by the open of the next candle, nothing wrong with that. That will serve you well all the days of your life. However, most traders tend to be tinkerers. And so they tinker and they build and they create. It's human nature. Our fathers and our grandfathers and our uncles used to do it in the garage. The modern day trader does it with code and with indicators on a computer. So I hope that answers your question. Thomas, your question, having the bracket order put, how do you recognize the second white bar currents? Let me go back to your initial question. Okay, I answered the question bracket order, but let me just read you the entire question. Hey, Jim, how do you know in the time of putting stop limit order whether the second bar would be white or red or blue? If you need to emanate more than one white bar occurrence, you have to be careful with orders because you do not know the color of a bar that follows the first white one. Thank you for your answer. Well, that's why you wait until the bar closes. Once the bar closes, it doesn't change color. Go ahead,
Jim. Yeah, you don't care the color of the bar that closes. It's the bar that follows the white bar. This is a gold market here. Let me take these arrows off, and we'll just kind of go through gold from this morning. And all right, so we'll just pick a spot and we'll start from here. So you've got a white. Let me make it bigger, and you can kind of understand what I'm showing you here. Make it a little bit bigger so it's easier to see. Okay, so you've got a white bar here. So you wait to see what the next bar is going to be. Well, this bar closes up at 1113.6. So initially, you know if it goes straight up, the bar is going to go 1, 2, 3, 4. It's going to close at 1114, or if it goes straight down, it's going to close down at 1113.2. So you know that that's going to be your entry and exit on the most extreme side. So you can put those orders in at that time and just wait. And as this bar paints itself, you'll be bringing your top one down because this bar is moving down. Well, the bar winds up closing down at 1113.3. So I would have had an order waiting at 1113.2. So I'd have got picked up short on this particular bar at 1113.2. Once this bar closed down below the MA1, this follows a lot of the same rules that you follow in the trading room, closed below the MA1, I would have moved to break even. As this bar went four more ticks, I would have locked in at the close of this bar. So I'd have been taken out of this trade on this pullback, but I would have gotten four ticks out of this particular trade. If we move on a little bit, there's a lot of white bars on gold today, so I don't know what's going on there. Now this white bar closed here, so the most extreme, your entry would have been here at 1114. Or 1114.1, so this one would have been an 8-tick stop out if you'd gone onto this trade. Now, one of the other rules that I've put in place is that if a white bar closes immediately after against my trade before I get 4 ticks to profit, I dump the trade. This one wouldn't have mattered because whether I'm in at 14 or 14.1, this drawback here would have been an 8-tick stop out. So this one, you'd have made 4 ticks, you'd have lost 8 ticks on this one. The next one here, white bar closes down, next bar opens, goes up a couple, comes down a couple, goes up a couple, winds up closing at 1113.5, so I would have had an order waiting at 1113.6. So we get 3 ticks of profit, 4, 7, 10. This one offers 11 ticks out of it. Now the way that I would have followed this is once this bar closed up here, I'd have gone to break even. This bar moved up, Didn't take me out of break even. This bar closed stuff, so I got four ticks out of this one also. So the two winning trades would have negated my losing trade. So at this point, I'd be break even on the day. So you watch for your single white bars to come in again. We're up to 8:48 in the morning. This one closes down. You have your order here. Now on this one, if you didn't get your order in quick enough, you could have actually got in at least a tick better here on the pullback. But if you got in at 11:13.5, this one offers 3, 5, 8, 9. This one offers 10 ticks. On this one, I probably would have gotten 4. I would have gotten at least 5 ticks out of this trade. So that's kind of how it goes. You wait for the white bars to come, single white bars, no trade here, no trade here, no trade here. And this is gold. I don't do a lot on gold because the other markets, the Russell and the crude and Euro, offer plenty of white bar trades. If you really enjoy trading gold, you can see that the gold, so far you've made at least 5 ticks on the day. You don't trade this one. These are nice when they happen, like when you have a single white bar, because it's changing direction, they're going on you, but unfortunately the two bars would have negated this trade. If you get a single white bar, and that's called, that's a hangman. When you get a hangman white bar, those are nice trades. Let's move on a little further here and see what else gold would have done today. Okay, we have a single white bar here. You could have gotten in on this one 11:12 or on the pullback 11:21. This would have been a break-even trade for me here. You can see even if it pulled back, it only pulled back 6-7 ticks, so you could have gotten out over on this point break-even on the down close below the MA1. It's a break-even trade. Okay, this single white bar here closes up. You probably would have gotten this one 11:15.3. You get 4, 5, 7 ticks of profit, so you could go to this point here. This one here would have pulled back and taken you out. You'd wind up with 4 ticks on that one. So now you're up 9 ticks on the day on 5 trades. Next one. Here's the hangman I was talking about. Hangman down closes, offers you 4 ticks. Depending if you took your 4 ticks and got out of this or if you stayed in it, you got 6 ticks of drawback here. 5 ticks of drawback, and then it goes south nicely. So at the very least, you probably got 4 ticks out of that trade. Depending on how long you stayed in it, you may have gotten quite a bit more. So we'll call it 4 ticks. So now you're at 13 ticks on 6 trades. And then this one here, we're getting late in the day now. This up closed here is at 12:23. Closes up. Now you could have gotten in better on this up close if you would have waited. Otherwise, you'd have been at 14.5, and you can see that one ran for a lot of ticks. I'm not even going to try to count it up for you. Next one's a down close. Unfortunately, this one would have been a stop out here. That would have been 8 tick stop out at 12:50 on this pullback. You've got an up close on this one. And I put this line in here because this was the swing high from before, just trying to see where it was trying to get to. So this is probably going to be a good trade here at 11:15.9. Hopefully that answered your question. Anything else I can try to answer for anyone out there?
Yeah, I got a couple more questions here. Okay. I've answered them in the chat box, but let me go back to, let's see, which question did I start with? Let me back up.
Somebody was asking why we had a different trade setup than what was in the room. I think it was the last one you answered.
Yeah, okay, I want to go to Don's question. Don says, in most of these trades, he's leaving a bunch on the table. Why are the stops so close that a small pullback takes him out as opposed to letting the winners run? Okay, that's a great question, Don. You always hear that. Cut the losers short and let the winners run. Unfortunately, no one ever really teaches you how to do that, do they? Now, we use aggressive risk management. And let's see, Don followed up with, see what you picked back up with. I think you had another comment. I'm trying to put everybody's comments together.
Sure.
Okay, after I explained about aggressive risk management, I said, yes, that is important, but once the daily goal is made, then why not let the winners run? And my answer was, well, that's what you do, but you still continue to use aggressive risk management because we don't like to give back that which we've already earned. So now let me allow you to answer why. Okay. you
uh,
do that?
I try to get to break even as soon as possible. I would rather, you know, pay the commission on a trade rather than lose one or two ticks on a trade. So I'm pretty aggressive at getting to break even. Once I get that four ticks of profit, I'm at the break even mark, and I start locking in ticks at that point. If I can get at least one tick locked in, it pays for the trade. And then let's see if I can find one here. We'll just kind of show you. Okay, now this particular trade here, this one closed up. That wouldn't have worked out. Let's find a winning trade where I left a bunch on the table. Let's go to one of my trades from today. Okay, here's one that's that ran on and on and on. So let's look at that trade. We make it a little bigger so everybody can see it real well.
Yeah, that's good.
Can see that? Okay. Okay, so this bar closed down here. Once I got to four ticks of profit, I took my stop to break even. Once this bar closed down here another eight ticks, I locked in four. As this one started moving down, I was going to try to lock in a full eight ticks on it, but unfortunately on this pullback here, it took me out. Now, if I would have locked in and just gone to break even, this bar here would have taken me out
at break even.
It came all the way back up at break even, and I still would have missed all this, and I wouldn't have gotten my five ticks. So once I get bars closing and they're closing below the MA1, you know, if you're a partner and you heard Michael say how important it is when it closes below the MA1, this bar closed below the MA1, went to break even. This bar closed below the MA1, locked in four, went to lock in another one, and got taken out of the trade on the pullback. So see, by locking in the five, I was able to get five ticks out of it as opposed to a break even and just pay commission. So that's why I follow so closely. Now, if I would have just stayed with my eight tick stop and just sat here, you know, for, let's see when this trade started, 9:50 all the way over to, when did it end? 10:03. So that's 13 minutes from the point, from the highest point to the lowest point. If I just would have waited 10 minutes, I could have locked in a whole bunch. But, you know, as traders, we don't do that. And with aggressive risk management, and I'm probably even more aggressive than Michael, I move my profit as quickly as I possibly can and lock in as much as I can. And you can see I had 25 trades today. No, is that right? 21 trades today. 21 trades with 48 ticks. That's a good day. And, you know, if I'm locking in three or I'm locking in.
That's an excellent day, but considering the 2420 blueprint says you're on track if you make eight ticks, or if you're trading, so you're trading Russell and gold, so that's $10
Russell
a tick.
Crude. Russell and crude.
Russell
yeah.
crude, I mean. Yeah. So that's, as long as you make 10 ticks in 10 trades or less, plus whatever carryover trades you have to work with, if you make 10 ticks and 10 trades or less, then you stay on target to graduate as a 20 contract trader in 24 months if you follow the 2420 blueprint. The only difficulty with following the blueprint is a crazy little thing called discipline, okay, which takes me to another question. And that the comment was originally, let's see, let me back up.
Well, let me explain this.
Go ahead.
In our first three trades today, my first three trades today on the white bars, I made six ticks, three ticks, and seven ticks. So in those first three trades, I was up 16 ticks. So even with a full eight tick stop out, I've still got eight ticks in my day. So I'm still, you know, as Dwayne says, at 16 ticks, I'm 100 plus whatever percentage, and the additional six ticks I've already have in my goal. The next win was three, the next one was six. So now I'm at 25 ticks in five trades. So I continue trading on, keeping in mind I've made my goal. I'm not going to risk my goal. So even if I lost two 16 tick stopouts in a row, I'm still at that 10 tick area, so I could quit for the day and I'd still have made my goal. So I've changed my business plan, and Dwayne and I have talked about that, and I'm pretty aggressive with the 2420. I am working the 2420 blueprint. I'm up in my contracts as I increase my bank account, not from anybody putting money into it, but from winnings in the market. And most days it works. Every day is not a winning day. There are some days when I lose money, and I consider those my expense days. But for the most part, I have winning days almost every day. think there was a question in there somewhere. Boom, there you go.
Let me go back to the question. Let's see. We already covered the I'm confused. And we talked about the different tools. Try to string together everybody, the individual person's comments, and try to make a thread. I guess I need to adapt what works for me. Absolutely, and I typed in, I agreed with you on that 100%. What works for you, boom. If it's, I mean, the basic slingshot, bullish cross, price pulls away, price pulls back to physically touch by the open of the next candle. That is all you ever need, along with learning to read market context, being able to read the chart. As Jonathin and I were doing yesterday, and as we did last week in the partners workshop, where Michael and I, we took the color out of the candles. We were working with nothing but pure white candles to show you, and I think that's really a great tool for each of you to work with in your own time to learn how to read market context. What is the story unfolding? Okay. Now, different traders may understand what's unfolding on different levels, but ask yourself, on what level do I understand what's unfolding? So let me go ahead and share what you wanted to share, and then I'll give you the next question.
I was just going to say that when you do kind of develop your own set of rules, your own technique, the way that you trade, because trying to get into to follow exactly what Michael does is impossible, and you're going to wind up getting in at the wrong price and getting stopped out. Just like if you tried to follow me on every single trade, I've gotten to where I'm pretty fast at this as far as getting in and getting out of the trades. But once you develop something that works for you, develop your own set of rules. These are the rules that I put together for the white bar trading, and I've passed these out to the partners, anyone that's interested in them. I've changed some of the trigger settings in the indicators to limit the number of white bars. My risk management, 8-tick stop, 4 ticks to break even, and the exception is if a second white bar paints before I get 4 ticks of profit and that white bar closes against my trade, I dump the trade. I would much rather dump the trade with a 4, 5, 6, even a 7-tick loss as opposed to a full 8-tick stop. And you can see from on the Russell when we were talking earlier, I dumped 2 trades. One was a 2-tick and one was a 3-tick loss, so 5 ticks lost on 2 trades as opposed to a full 16. So my other rules are I avoid a doji when it's followed by the white bar. If there's more than more than one white bar, I avoid those trades. So you develop your own set of rules, and that's through time in the simulator, looking at charts. And like Dwayne says, if you just sit down at your computer and you trade for 90 to 120 minutes a day and you walk away, you're never going to see a level of success. When I get done with my trades, I spend another hour going through the charts, looking at what worked, what didn't work, what I could have done, what I should have done, and then there's a lot of times after dinner in the evening, I'll go back and I'll pull the charts up again and I'll start assessing the trades. I'm constantly changing my business plan to associate or to incorporate different things that I'm trying, but I stick to my rules, I stick to my trading plan and my business plan. And then when I'm all done trading, if there's something that I look at, I go, you know what, this isn't working for me anymore. That rule's got to change, and I've got to go to the new rule. But once you change something, you got to stick with it. You got to be disciplined as far as, you know, if this works for you and this is what you're doing, then do it. Do it every time. Don't change your business plan while you're trading. Don't change your rules while you're trading. If it's not working for you, shut the computer down, reassess why it's not working, and then try to come back at it a different day. But if you start changing things while you're trading, you'll really screw yourself up. And I'm speaking from experience. I've done that. I've blown up many accounts to get to where I'm at now, and CFRN is the first company that I've been with that I've seen any level of consistent success.
When you write your business plan, you should write in how often you're going to bring your trading plan up for review. Okay? You don't change it every day. You don't change it every other trade. You can review it weekly. That's a little too short of a time frame, I think. You can bring it up for review every couple weeks. I think probably minimum would be a month, okay? Because a month gives you a large enough sample size to determine if something in fact, should be changed. Now, we gave Jim the handle Jim Whitebar Cox. In hindsight, what would really have been the better handle, I think, would be Jim follows his rules, Cox. Because you see, guys, the magic is not in the white bar. That's not the magic. You know, the magic, if there's any magic involved, and it's not magic, okay, it's discipline, is that he has a firm set of rules, and he adheres to those rules time after time, trade after trade, day after day, week after week. That's the consistency. The market is going to be uniquely different each and every day. The economic events, news events that come out, Putin putting an airstrike on Syria, dock workers going on strike where they bring in soybeans. I mean, it's an endless array of changing things. You have to become the constant integer in the equation, okay? Now, it's easy to look at Jim's work and go, oh, okay, well, the secret's in the white bar. So if I just put that indicator on and I just wait for the white bar to show up, then I'll do as well as Jim. Yet many people find that that's far from the case because it's so much beyond, okay? I mean, you could literally write a trading plan that says every time a commercial comes on CNBC, I'm going to flip a coin and either go long or short. You know what? That's a random entry, but you have to understand, in this flow of events, in this current in which we trade, this never-ending flow of opportunity, okay, each trade setup that appears, based on whatever criteria you've established, whether it's a wide bar or a commercial comes on CNBC and you flip a coin, okay, whatever criteria you've set, the outcome of every trade is random. Let me say that again. The outcome of every trade is random. There is a random distribution of wins and losses, profitable and non-profitable trades. I like that terminology much better than winning and losing. So no matter how, in fact, when Mark Douglas, rest his soul, when Mark was on the show, someone asked a question and he pointed out, Mark, by the way, was a friend and the author of the book Trading in the Zone and The Disciplined Trader and his third book, which is yet to come out. He said the secret to success, if there is such a thing in trading, he said it is not in the analysis. It's not in getting the perfect entry. It's in how you manage your trade once you're in it. And if you manage it this way one time and another way the next time and another way the next time, then you never develop a consistent formula which, when applied over a large enough sample size, gives you more profitable trades and or points than losses. Okay? That's a big lesson. It's a lot to take in. Mark did a very incredible job of explaining that in Trading in the Zone. If you have not read the book, if you've not listened to the book, that needs to be the next thing on your to-do list. Go ahead, Jim.
Okay, I just did a quick white bar trade here on the Russell. I showed you this bar had closed up, so we went long here. And where did my Russell Dom go? Just bring that over so you can see. We went long on the up close. Got some drawback on it. Once we got close above the MA1, I went to break even. As this bar closed up, I locked in one tick to pay for it, came back and took me out with the one tick, so we made one tick on that trade. Left some more money on the table, which we talked about before, but unfortunately, by following aggressive risk management, I was able to get one tick out of that that Russell trade. Now here on gold, there's a white bar happening right now. I want to show you how the trade works. Got the white bar. Next bar's got three ticks moved up, so fourth tick would be at 16.4, so I've got an entry long at 16.5. And then four ticks down would be at 15.9, so I put my entry at 15.8. So whichever way this bar goes, if it goes short, I've got a short entry. If it goes long, I've got a long entry. The bar has not completed itself yet, so these numbers may adjust, but right now I just kind of sit and be patient and wait to see what the bar is going to do. So and that's kind of how the white bar works for me. I get my orders on as quickly as I can, and as the bar paints itself, I adjust those orders accordingly. So if we get one more tick up, that brings our short entry up a tick. If it takes us long, cancel hey, that short entry.
Do me a favor there. Slide your DOM over just a tad to the right. Okay, on the chart that you're trading the gold chart?
Yes, that's one on the end here.
No, you've got crude up.
No, that's gold.
Crude's over here.
I'm trying over here. Okay, so what happened?
So up there in the upper right-hand corner of the chart, that little tab that opens up the chart properties.
On this one?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, pop that open for just a second. And turn on your countdown timer. You got to scroll all the way to the top.
Okay.
I want to see how it plays out on this chart.
Countdown timer, show timer.
Oh, you've got yours on already.
It's on. Okay.
Okay. So that
it doesn't work unless you're on a time factor, does it? I mean, on a range chart, it won't work.
Well, see, that's the thing. I found out last night because I had changed one of my charts during the show yesterday to a 5-minute, and I was showing how with the range chart, we know where the next candle is going to open. I said, versus a time chart, we can know when the next candle is going to open. And so I was using the timer to show how it counts down the minutes, you know, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 to your next candle on a 5-minute chart or on a 1-minute mm-hmm. chart. And I noticed when I went back to the 4-tick range that on my platform, on my little tab down at the bottom, and I guess Michael noticed it was up at the top as well, when a new candle opens, it shows 4. Or no, yeah. Yeah, it shows 4. Then it goes 3, 2, 1, and I get a new candle. So that's not something that we have worked with people on using. It's not displaying that on yours. No, wait, it is.
I don't know why.
No, it is. Look over there at crude. It just went to 0. Then it went to 3. Look up there. At the top, very top, right where it says default. See, it just went to 1. Very, very top of the chart.
Oh, right here. Okay, I got you.
0.
Okay, I see.
Now, see, it went to 2.
Okay.
1.
Well, those of you that just watched this trade, this was a white bar. The mm-hmm. bar closed down. I put an entry in. It picked me up and took me down. I followed it. I got 8 ticks of profit out of that particular trade right there. Took me out on this pullback. Went to break even here. Locked in 4 here. When this one closed down here, I locked in 8, and then it came back and took me out of that trade there with 8 ticks. Now, had I stayed back further, it's continuing down, but like I said, I got 8 ticks. Now, this trade here, we're at break even on the gold trade right now. It's given 4 ticks to profit. I've gone to break even. So that's kind of how the white bars work. Hopefully, showing that to you kind of gives you a better understanding of what I'm doing. Get that out of the way there.
So that gold chart is now saying that you need 2 more ticks to get a new candle.
Yep.
Here's what I'm thinking is that when the new candle opens, whichever way it moves first, I don't think it doesn't flip-flop back and forth. I think it just counts in one direction. Okay, let me get some more questions here. Now, Don's going back to, if the initial risk of 4 ticks were left intact, then he would not get stopped out with a 2-3 tick. Well, there's not an initial risk of 4 ticks. The initial risk, Don, is 8 ticks.
Correct.
You risk 8 ticks on every trade. Would not get stopped out with a 2-3 tick pullback, and then the big winners would manifest. On another point, I presume the red and green dotted lines are resistance and support. Those are dynamic resistance and support. They are dynamic because they are calculated live in real time. Some very heavy mathematical lifting going on in the background. We have fixed support and resistance in the way of our weekly trading zones, so we know ahead of time, you know, a week ahead of time, where the market is going to comfortably find support and resistance. We know the areas where price will be attracted to. The dynamic support and resistance, okay, it is dynamically on the spot doing calculations to show you where, based on current price movement, the market has established an area of support and where it will find, in turn, resistance. Okay. Now, you've got them showing on your chart, but I don't think you factor, do you factor them into your trading at all?
Yes and no. If price is stuck at a particular level, I'll wait until we get through that level before I trade long or short, just like with the weekly trading zones. If they get stuck in there and they've been in there for quite a while, I'm going to wait for it to get to either side, because a trending market works better with the white bars, just like it does with just about every other trade. So the one thing I was going to say also is that you just saw me do three white bar trades, one on crude, one on gold, one on Russell, one tick, eight ticks. So there's 10 ticks. There is your goal for the day in what did it take us, 5 minutes sitting here just looking at the white bars.
Mm-hmm.
So it just kind of shows you how the white bars work. But
Don, your question, how does the white bar set up? If you're asking what creates the white bar, it's a mathematical equation that Michael and I have running in the background. It's the TC stands for trend change. And I posted a chart on the Google Plus page a couple days ago. And I also, I showed the chart on the radio show yesterday. Now, I was on an hourly. See, Jim, on an hourly chart, if you change yours right now, you'll probably.
Uh-oh, that doesn't look good. All right, so this is the CFTC.
Yeah. So.
Let me click to an hourly and see what it does.
It's going to probably mess you up, but I guess that's okay. You know, go back to Friday at 1 o'clock and see if you have a white candle.
Friday was the 23rd.
25th.
Is that right?
25th.
So I don't – the white candle on the 25th? Yes, I have a white candle right here.
See
on the 25th.
Now that's interesting. It's identical to what I had. Mm-hmm. And so what I was pointing out, and I had just the CFMA1 running on the chart that I published. And so the story was that price had, if you go down, just go left where your cursor is now to that swing low right there. Okay. So we have a leg up and a retracement, a leg up. And a retracement.
Yeah, we have a gap here.
Mm-hmm. And then a leg up.
Big leg.
And a retracement.
Big retracement.
We failed to get the leg that should have appeared there. So now we're under a red CFMA1 and falling. Our cycle indicator at the bottom on the slingshot is red and falling. And I even gave it the benefit of, let's see, the entry candle, which was two candles after the white candle, that was 1 o'clock on my chart. No, to the left.
This one?
Uh-huh. Because I was trying to show the entry after a down candle, after the white candle. I was just projecting it on an hourly chart. So what time do you have on that candle, the one to
11,
the right of it?
12 o'clock.
Okay, you've got 12 Eastern?
Central.
So that's 1 Eastern.
Right.
So that's identical to the chart. Guys, if you go out to the Google Plus page, you'll see that chart, that identical chart, okay, generated on my computer. See, originally with the CFTC, we did not use it on a smaller time frame in the trading room. I used it bigger picture. See, utilizing how we originally configured it, programmed it, built it, coded it, was that if we were taking a bigger picture look at the Russell, we would have had, now, the weighting of bar, that's something that Jim kind of brought into the picture, but we would have potentially weighted that because what you're looking, the white candle is an indication of a potential change of trend. It's like a warning. It's like somebody waving a flag going, hey, something important may be about to happen here. Now, with us, it could have been 1, 2, 3 candles. Okay, when Jim brought it into the four-tick range arena, that's when he threw in that rule that he uses of the single white candle. Okay, that was not a part of our original idea and concept, but as we've just seen, as he's gone through these charts, because he built a set of rules around that particular thing, it's worked out very nicely for him. Okay, and
even on the larger time frame here, even the hour chart with this white bar, and then this bar here closes down. It opens at, what does it open at?
You would have been short the Russell since Friday. I don't know.
I'd have been short 11:30.3. Now, once I got a close above the MA1, though, I'd have probably been looking to get out of this trade.
Sure.
So once I got this close here at 11:14.4, I'd have dumped the trade. But look how much you could make in that. You got in short here, 11:30.2, and getting out at 11:14.4.
On a bigger picture trade such as that, though, you might possibly consider trailing your stop behind the EBC.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, now, let's see, do you have, come forward, because we're all the way up to Wednesday. And so what's happened on your chart? Okay, there was a white candle. So see, we did not have a close above the BBC until
right
there.
The 29th yesterday at 11 o'clock last night.
Yeah, right. And then look what followed up, a bearish cross. And then what happened? Price pulled away. Price pulled back to physically touch. Up close by the open of the next candle, and off you go.
So you'd be long at 1087, and currently you'd be up 1093.1.
Nice
so
day.
So what is that? Yeah, it's a real nice day.
87 to 93, what is that, 6 points?
Mm-hmm.
Which is $600 per contract in the Russell, $100 per point. Okay, let me get to some more of these questions. I'll go back through them, guys, and if I missed part of any of the questions that you've asked, because I was trying to keep them in a thread, but I got confused. Eugene Dwayne, can you ask Jim, how does he deal with some days where the white bar just fails more often than it's profitable? I paper traded the crude with the white bar rules that Jim uses, and some days I was amazed where 90% of trades were profitable, while the other days the exact opposite happened. What do you do when that happens?
Well, like I said, there is nothing out there that's 100% every time. So you're going to see days that are better than others. Today was a good day. Yesterday was a 21-tick day. Today is a 48-tick day. So the thing is, you keep trading the advantage that you have. You keep trading your system or your technique or the slingshot or whatever you're using, you stick to it. You don't panic. You don't freak out, because over the long haul, it comes out to be very profitable. There was a time, I guess it was last week or 2 weeks ago, I was trading, and the white bars just were not working on a consistent basis. And I struggled to even get to the 10 ticks each day. But then this week it's been, you know, 20, 25, 30, today's 48 ticks. So as long as you're getting to that 10 tick goal, and then those are your slow weeks, and then your busier weeks are when you're making more ticks, it averages out over the long haul for you. And don't get me wrong, there are days when you'll have negative numbers, but in my business plan, I've set daily loss limits for myself, so if I hit that limit, I shut it off regardless of what I think I can or can't do as far as trying to recover, and I walk away from it. Because it seems like from past experience, whenever I chase the market or I try to get my money back, by the end of the day, I've lost way more than I would have had I walked away.
Yeah, you get beat like a redheaded stepchild. I can say that because my wife's a redhead. So.
Okay, very good.
Yeah.
I was gonna do a trade here, but I got to talk and I missed it. 45.05 would have been long.
Mm-hmm.
It's already given 7 ticks of profit, so you don't want to jump into that one now. But you can see up close here, if you'd have waited, you could have got in better on the pullback. But even if you got in at 45.05, it had 3 ticks of pullback, and now it's moved 4-6 ticks in profit. So on this particular trade, this close here, I'd have been at break even. I'd still be sitting at break even now waiting to see if I was going to get an up close. I might have locked in a tick just to pay for the trade, but this is probably a one tick or break even trade at this point. And this area here, let me get this out of the way, the crude market does not have weekly trading zones. Dwayne doesn't provide those, but when you start trading and you start seeing, let me close this up a little, you start seeing areas that price is hanging out at, you know, the buyers and the sellers are fighting over which way it's going to go. This is from the inventory trades today. And you can see that played out for pretty much the day. Stuck in that area, came down, touched it, and bounced away. And then this is where it all started. It was right here during the inventory trades. They couldn't decide what they wanted to do with price, and they fought in that area. So that to me, when I see something like that, I highlight it, and then I watch it through the rest of the day because I know there's going to be a problem in that area. We got through it here, came right back to it, got through it. And you can correct me if I'm wrong here, Dwayne. I'm speaking something that is going to confuse people.
What?
Back to it. These areas of support and resistance, when they develop themselves earlier in the day, they play out for pretty much the entire trading day.
Important prices and important areas are almost always tested.
Well, there you go.
Just like when David was talking earlier on the show, he said he told his guys today after crude ran up, he said he told them, I believe, get short down to 45.10, something to that effect. Well, interestingly enough, last night, if you take a look at the Concierge Trade Alerts, I told everybody at 7:40 p.m. Eastern to get long above 45.10. So I saw the market from a get long perspective at 45.10. But once the market had ran up to its zenith or its apex or whatever you want to call it, then David saw it in a different light and without, and I'm sure he wasn't looking at my alerts, then he told his guys that we can short this back to 45.10. Important prices and important areas are just that. It's a universal kind of a thing, okay? And what Jim's saying about these areas of support and resistance that you find in the market, don't let anybody tell you that support and resistance is broken, because it's not, okay? And price will be attracted to these same areas again and again and again. When I recap the Concierge Trade Alerts and I do it on a 4-tick range chart, there will be days with crude or Russell or whatever market it might be where I go 10, 10, 10, 10, 10, because it just keeps coming right back to the trigger and going. Comes back to the trigger and goes. Comes back to the trigger and goes. Now, it doesn't always go just 10. It might go 15. It might go 20. but I only mark it, I only highlight it at the 10 tick mark because that's our goal for the day. But I've often sat here with a crude chart for a day and we might have 20 triggers in crude over the course of a trading day, breaking it down to the 4 tick range chart. Okay, if you go back to around March of this year on the Google Plus page and prior, you'll see me painstakingly day after day going through every market, all 8 markets, tick by tick, bar by bar. That's why some of those daily shows you'll see are 4, 5, even 6 hours, because I spent so much time recapping in a very granular manner how to take advantage of the concierge trade alerts. Okay? It's not magic. It's not some black box thing that spits out a number. It comes from the ability to read the market, to read the chart, and to understand where the important prices and important areas are. If you stick around me long enough, you're going to learn how to do that. Now, you'll learn to do it a little differently perhaps than I do. Just as Jim, he's just telling you, you know, Dwayne doesn't give us any weekly zones here, but I can look at a chart and I can see that price goes from here to here, back to here, back to here, back to here. How long will that continue to go on? Until it doesn't. And then it will find a new comfort zone and it will go from here to there to here to there to here to there. You can see it on a 1-minute chart, on a 4-tick range chart, a 5-minute chart, a daily chart, an hourly chart, a weekly chart. And Don had asked, could you show crude or bond on a daily chart with the white bar? And if it's going to mess up your charts, I'll do it when I take the charts back.
No, that's all right. I don't have anything on my bond chart here. I'll bring it over. Let's go to, you want to do an hourly or daily? What do you want to do, Dwayne?
Let's see. What did he ask for? Hang on. Can you show a crude or a bond daily chart with the white bar?
Daily chart. Okay. Daily chart.
Now, hourly and daily is how I was going back 3-4 years on the radio show. Each day when the show opened up, instead of the hourly chart that you see me displaying now, I was displaying something like this, okay? Except I was displaying it on the hourly. Now, you have a cluster of white bars there in the left, so that's a heads up. Price may be going in a different direction. It looks like price had been climbing, and then price pulled back. Okay. Now, once you get these blue candles are starting to develop, you've got a CFMA1 that's blue and climbing. That's a call for higher prices. You've got a cycle that's blue and it's as bullish as it gets up there, okay? Now, some might look at that and go, oh, well, that's overbought. We don't go and get into overbought and oversold because a market can stay oversold for, let's see, how many days? That first blue candle was July 17th, and then the one with the big wick at the top, August 24th. Mm-hmm. So that's a trade that a person could have been in from literally July, whatever it was, 17th.
17th.
To whatever point you get out. Now, maybe the point that you get out is after that white candle and the appearance of the first red candle. Maybe you say, okay, I'm out. Did you leave some on the table? Yes. But did you take something significant out of the market? Yes. And did you have to fester over every little tick? No. But you have to understand that the personality required to be a swing trader is very different from the personality required to trade intraday. if you're going to take this big position, you know, and you're up $400 or $600 or $4,000 or $6,000, you take the family to dinner, you're in pretty good mood, and, you know, you're not supposed to use your phone at the dinner table in the restaurant, but you ease it out of your pocket and under the table, you look and you realize that that $6,000 is evaporated and you're at the zero line. And you're like, sorry, kids, no dessert. We got to get home because you got to get on your computer and get out of that position. So by the time you get home, you're only down $2,000. Whew. If traffic hadn't been so bad, you could have been out with only a $1,000 loss. But you get out, you're thankful, you go to bed, you wake up tomorrow morning and the position's up $20,000. Now, you got to have a really strong constitution to roll with those punches. Okay? Now, there's people that do it. Plenty of people do it. Other people, I mean, some people can adapt to that scenario that I just laid out. They can adapt to that better than they can adapt to what we do intraday in the live trading room, which is very intense, very focused, got to be on your toes. Now, that, of course, you have to develop personality traits that allow you to be comfortable with that type of trading. Remember, if it were easy, everybody would do it. But trading's not easy. However, it can be simple. Okay. Here, Jim's showing what kind of time. Are you back on a 4 tick? Okay.
Back to the 4 tick. And there's a white bar that just closed up at 157.08. So we would go ahead and buy 157. You can tell I didn't use the sim trading today. 157.08. So we're long at 157.08. Actually, let me shrink this down so we can put the DOM up there next to it.
And also in your favor, for a long trade, you decide a bullish cross.
Mm-hmm.
Cycle is blue and starting to climb.
If we get an up close on this bar, we're going to be in good shape on this trade, I think. But we'll see. The thing about bonds is bond moves really, really slow. So
yes,
maybe we'll get to see this trade finish out, and maybe we won't.
You could be in this. Let's see. The bond... The trade alert was short below 157.13, and we're below that right now, okay? So this would be a good point for it to try to pull its way back up. Let's see. And then the long side's way the heck up there, so.
Now, if this bar closes up, it'll be above the CFMA1, so I would go to break even on that, but... We've got to get to a break-even point, and that's the whole goal, to get to break-even as quickly as we can, because then all we're doing is look at commission until we start locking in our profit.
Okay, Jeanette, I just put the CFTC on the 6E. All the candles are white. What you need to do is you need to go into, you need to right-click, open all active indicators, go to the CFTC, click on properties, and tell it that you want the bullish candle to be green and the bearish candle to be red.
Okay, we've got a close above the CFMA1. I've gone ahead and gone to break even. So now we'll sit and see where it goes. Jenna, I can pull that open for you if you want to see what that looks like. Okay, it took us out. That turned into a break even trade for us.
Okay.
Let's see if I can get this open for Jeanette here. Indicators, all active. These are going to be your settings as far as your numbers trigger, numbers up. So change those numbers to that. That limits the number of white bars that you get. And then your color is going to be red and up color is going to be blue. Can they take a picture of these like they can in a webinar, Dwayne?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a little camera sitting up at the top. You can't see it, but everybody else can. All they got to do is just click it.
So hopefully that gives you the information. Did you get Jeanette, just take a picture up in your upper right-hand corner of your screen. There should be a little camera. Take a picture of that so that you can change these numbers, because otherwise you'll be inundated with white bars. Okay.
And Don, in answer to your question about the DOM, this is OEC Trader, not DT Pro. Is that what it's called, OEC Trader?
No, it's Infinity. It's through Transact.
Yeah, but the actual platform is called, isn't it called OEC Trader, I think?
I don't know.
Okay.
I thought it was called Infinity, but I could be wrong.
No, that's the brokerage. No, it's okay. A white label platform. So anyway, let's see. What are the questions? Jeanette, did you get it to work? Okay, Keith asked a great question. Keith asked, Keith obviously someone who has read and spent some time with trading in the zone. If you're listening to this broadcast, you've not, and if you don't own Trading in the Zone by Mark Douglas, you can save yourself a whole lot of headaches and really get a fresh start on life as a trader by getting a hold of that book. Now, our sponsor, Audible, will allow you to download a copy absolutely free. The instructions are at the beginning of the radio show every day. Go to audibletrial.com/CFRN. Take their free trial. They will give you one free book if you take their free trial. If you decide to cancel after your free trial, you don't want to be a member of the book club, the free gift, the free book, is yours to keep forever. It's a 7.5-hour book. Mark wrote 3 books. He called me the night before he passed to tell me that he had finally finished the last 3 paragraphs that he had been working on for a number of days. And he was very relieved that he had it completed. And, of course, none of us knew what was coming the next day. So he said, Dwayne, this is going to, there won't be any more questions. And he was, now, when I first met him 3 years ago, he thought he was maybe 3 to 6 months away from completing this book. That's the type of a perfectionist that he was, and dedication to his craft, and that it stretched into, and it's not because it was of his own doing, because his plan for this final book was to self-publish, because he did not like to, you know, some of the things that happened with previous publishers. Now that things have worked out the way they did, I'm not sure Paula, his wife, how she's going to deal with that. So, in fact, Mark and I were talking about that evening, along with so many other things, about how distribution would be handled. And I own a company, it's dormant right now, Product Services International, and we were a product fulfillment company. And so I told him, if you need assistance with that part of the project, let me know, and I'll be happy to blow the dust off the company and help you out. So something I will ultimately talk with Paula about.
The Russell's given us a white bar opportunity here. Now, if this one closes down, it's going to be a doji, so I'm taking my down order off. Now, that closes a doji, so I took the order off, because those don't tend to work out as well as the full-painted candles. So that would be no trade there. So you saw when it looked like it was going to be a doji, I took that short order off.
Don, it's a white-label platform. The white-label version from Daniels is called DT Pro. The white label version from some of the, all of these platforms are running off the OEC backbone. Okay.
Yes.
With the exception of Ninja. So they're basically all the same. You can paint them up and make them look different. You can slap your name on it. If we wanted to become introducing brokers, and we get that offer all the time, then we could have our own version, and instead of it being called DT Pro, it would be called the CFRN Trader, or whatever clever name we might want to give it. That's how that works. It's just like you can buy shampoo wholesale in China by the boatload, and when it gets here, or even before it leaves there, you can have your label slapped on it. It's basically a generic product, but you label it and you build a story around it and you tell people why it's the best shampoo. And of course you want to try to make sure it is good shampoo. And I'm just using that as an example. You don't want antifreeze in your shampoo like they put in the toothpaste. So quality control, very important. You must have some boots on the ground. That's a sort of a real world product in hand analogy to how it works with trading platforms. Okay. Now, there are trading platforms that are completely independent. TradeStation, right? Although you can tie TradeStation into the OEC backbone, because if you've ever tried executing with TradeStation, unless something has changed, and I'm a certified TradeStation developer, so sorry, guys, but executing with them was a bit of a nightmare. And so people who like charting with TradeStation can now execute on the OEC backbone, which means you could send a trade into your Daniels trading account by using the little plugin called AutoX. So it's probably more information than anybody needed.
We're all confused now.
Are you? No, you're not.
No, I'm teasing. I was going to say
that. Thank you very much. I would ask that you would pray for Mark's wife. And her name's Paula. If you would pray for her, your generosity and your offer to pray. I'm very touched by that. So I want to say thank you. And as I mentioned yesterday, I'm doing a little bit of whale watching. And so I would ask that you, if you want to pray for me, and again, I think that's just very nice. It transcends being nice. You could pray for my, I can't even spell it. And my son's sick. He's got the flu. But boy, he's a trooper and he'll bounce right back. So thank you so much.
I lost my signal yesterday listening to the show, mm-hmm. and I heard you say you had a life-changing experience as you were leaving the grocery store, and then I didn't get to hear what that was.
Yeah, I just had a vision of going to work. I've worked with hundreds, thousands of people over the last, well, we're now into our second decade, and I was just stopped in my tracks of what it would be like to work with just one person. And by one person, it doesn't mean that we would abandon our clients here and stop teaching or training, but my focus would be it's one thing to trade a $10,000 account. It's another thing to trade a $1 million account. And it's another thing altogether to trade a $100 million account, because soon you're starting, you have to start looking for where you can put this money to work and how you'll put it to work. It's a whole different type of strategy that comes into play. For instance, you get intraday margins on bonds, I'll use as an example, whatever the intraday margin is, I think you're only allowed 25 contracts before you have to self-report. As you start mm-hmm. to get into size, all kinds of other things come into play. And so, it's a little hard to convey the moment and the revelation, but I had a similar experience back in 2000. And I likened that day unto this day, and they felt very similar. So I'm not going to rush out and start tacking up. Have you seen my whale posters on the telephone poles? I'm just going to sit back and see what passes by. That's what whale watchers do. They just sit on the boat or on the deck, and every now and then you go, whoa, there's one, because you see the spout. So whatever God's got, whatever God's got in plan for me, he knows where I live. So
with my luck, I'd be swallowed up like Jonah. So anyway, if anybody else has any questions,
Keith says, Jim, what about this system puts you into the carefree state of mind and all the others didn't put you into a carefree state of mind? Well, now, Keith, that's, you're making an assumption that the others didn't put him in a carefree state of mind, but maybe they didn't, so go ahead.
I don't know that it's such a carefree state of mind. The thing I like about the system is that when you look at the chart, the white bar jumps out at you. So the white bar is a signal to me, hey, look at my chart, look at me, look what I'm doing here, and it gets my attention drawn to that particular market. And that way I can see a white bar and I decide to go short. You know, when it's just trending and nothing's going on like over here on the euro, you know, I don't really pay attention to what's happening over there. And the market says painting the white bar draws my attention in. I've got a specific entry for it, whether it's short or long, depending on which way the bar closes. So I wouldn't say it's carefree, and the other ones were the cause of me some grief. I think the problem before was that I didn't see the entries as clearly as I do now. And in trying, when I first came to CFRN, I did like everybody else does, and I tried to mirror Michael, and that doesn't work out so well. So if you're doing that, don't do that. But this gives me a clear entry and good focus on the market when the white bar presents itself.
That answer your question? You are correct, Carson. Gain bought OEC. Gain bought a controlling interest in Daniel's trading with an option to purchase the rest. I believe it's a controlling interest. It was a 49.51 deal. Maybe Daniel still has a controlling. I think Gain does. Anyway, it doesn't affect us. Let's see, Michael. Would you ever consider an auto trail after four ticks of profit? Jim?
Let me bring it down over. You can see on my DOM, I've got a trailing stop and a trigger. If I get in, I'll adjust. It's either going to be four or three. Mm-hmm. Trigger four ticks. I go to three ticks of profit. I'm sorry. I follow it by three ticks. So I do have an auto set up to get me to break even. And once I get to break even, I just kind of trail it with the close of each of the bars. That's pretty much the only automation that I use. I know that DT Pro is a little bit more intricate as far as the DOM, because you can set it that at four ticks you go to break even, at six ticks you go to five ticks, at 10 ticks you go to eight ticks. So I don't do all that. I just do it manually.
The one that is the most nimble by far is Ninja when it comes to being able to set various levels, like John M. There's a video in the members area of the website where he lays out his strategy, and he's trailing, of course, he goes to break even. He goes to break even plus one at four ticks, and then he trails by four, then he trails by three, I think it is, and then once he hits 10 ticks, it tightens up, and he's trailing by only two ticks, because I mean, that 10 ticks, that's your day maker right there. And so he's making a statement. If this is my first trade of the day, once I hit 10 ticks, no way am I giving back eight of those ticks. I'm definitely banking eight, and we'll see where we go from there. So, and it could lead into a 15-tick trade or a 20-tick trade, or it could come back and take him out at eight, okay? So now he puts on his business management hat and goes, based upon the rollover equity that I have from previous days, do I want to borrow two ticks, or do I want to put on another trade and risk getting stopped out for a full eight ticks? So do you understand this? It's a trading hat and then the business manager hat. and you have to know which one to put on when and how to make the proper decisions. Okay, Casey says, I'm trying to figure out lack of not wanting to take a loss, especially after having several winning trades in a row and thinking that, okay, this trade will work out. I just entered too early. What results is I usually end up losing, unprofitable. That last trade wiped me out. I have done this over and over again. All right, let me go back to your original question. And I think I already read it, but let me scroll back up. Keep going. Well, there's a ton of questions in here. Guys, if I missed a question, because there's so many questions in here, copy and paste it in the bottom real quick, because I know Jim's got to go and I've got to run too. But I wanted to go back to your original comment where you said, I'm going to find it.
If anybody has a question for me, Dwayne's been good enough to give me a website at CFRN. It's jim@cfrn.net. So if anyone has a question that I can answer for you, just feel free to email me. And I check those about once a day. So if I don't get back with you right away, I will at some point during the day.
Okay. Here was the original question that I was trying to find. I am just searching. But really, my problem is that I trade very well for a couple days, and then I give it all back in one day. Now, the answer that I had typed in was a question. I said, well, why do you do that? Okay. Now, this is a common thing. We're all familiar with it. You do very well for a few days, and then in one day, you give it all back. All right. Now, my question was, well, why do you do that? Or why do you allow that to happen? Or why does that happen? Now, let me get back down to your next comment. And then we're going to wrap this thing up here. So please, if you have a question that went unanswered, copy and paste it at the bottom of the chat box real quick. Okay, back to the same person. I'm going to read this again. I'm trying to figure out a lack of not wanting to take a loss, especially after having several winning trades in a row. Okay, well, here's the thing. If you've had several winning trades in a row, if you have your goal for the day, you shouldn't be thinking about putting on another trade, okay? Now, don't try to be Michael. Don't try to be Jim, okay? Just because somebody else keeps going, what you're telling me right there is when I try to keep going, I end up messing up and I have a problem and I'm not profitable. I think my best advice to you is to get focused on making your daily goal and stop. Because when you make your daily goal in two or three trades, you're rolling forward seven unused trades. If you do it in three trades, you roll forward seven trades. Tomorrow you got 17 trades to make 10 ticks. Make your 10 ticks, stop, roll forward all those unused trades. Pretty soon, you could be sitting on 30, 40, 50 rollover trades. At that point, there should not be a day, hopefully, that you aren't able to make your 8 or 10 ticks. My best advice is once you've hit your goal for the day, stop. Jim, let's finish up with your comment on that, and I think we're done.
I would agree, especially if you're a new trader. Get your 10 ticks and shut it down. If you want to watch Michael trade or you want to practice on the sim, that's one thing. But once you hit that goal, you've got to walk away because you will give it back. Even on, like I said, the days where I've had losses, I turn it off and I regroup for the next day because to chase it or to try to get money back in the account, it seems like it always, every time, ends in just a phenomenal loss for the day. And I've had catastrophic losses, and I've blown up many accounts. So just take it from someone who's lost a fortune. When you get to your goal, walk away. And if you're having one of those sit down to trade and you don't feel like you're in sync with the market and every trade is a struggle and every trade you're sweating and your heart's beating, it's time to shut it down, get back into the simulator until you feel comfortable, and then come back to trading.
That is correct. Michael, in answer to your question, it's 10 ticks net. Okay. If it takes you 10 trades every day, if it takes you 10 trades every single day to make your daily goal, it will take you 47 trading days to increase your account balance by $2,000 so that you can add your second contract. Say it again, if it takes you 10 trades every day to make 10 ticks, in 47 trading days, you will have increased your account balance by $2,000, and per the blueprint, you will be able to add a second contract. Okay, let me just get these switched over. There we go. Okay. We're back home. Yeah. All right. How do you rid yourself of ego? Just stop. Ego, I'm not sure how ego fits into that because if you're having a problem of blowing up accounts and, you know, making money for a couple of days and then returning those funds to the market, I don't think that's an ego issue. I think it's a discipline issue. Remember, what I said about Jim's methodology, the secret to his success, I believe, is yes, he's using the white bar as a signal, as a heads up to look for a position, long or short. But what really makes it work is not the white bar itself. It's what he does after the white bar, how he manages the trade. He's got a very strict set of rules, and he sticks to it, period. Okay? Sticks to it. All right. Let's see. What are the stats on the white bar trade? Michael, that's one of the most dangerous type of questions you could ever ask anybody about any kind of trading methodology. It's dangerous. I mean, you're among friends here, so nobody's going to lie to you, okay? But when you ask those types of questions about a system or methodology, they can tell you anything, okay? They can even give you charts. You know, pie charts and graphs and a long list of numbers, right? Just like people will ask me about the concierge trade alert. Well, what's the percentage? Well, I mean, what's the percentage of trades that are taken long at 9 a.m. in soybeans? Or are you referring to the trades that are taken short between midnight and 1 a.m. on Tuesdays? You see, there are too many variables involved. Okay, now you could narrow it down. Okay, I'm only talking about the S&P. I'm only talking about real-time trading hours. And I'm going to assume that you'll execute on a four-tick range chart. And I'm going to assume that you'll never go to the bathroom or have coffee, so you won't ever miss a trade. You see what I'm saying? While people, I mean, the internet is filled with people touting all of these incredible statistics, 98% profitability. This one guy, Bill, he's an older gentleman. I'm really quite surprised by him. And we never have a losing day. I think he says they never even have a losing trade. Maybe it's a, I guess it's a losing, never have a losing day, never, in years. I've listened to him talk. He seems like a very nice fellow. Just have to be careful, okay? It's possible to cook the books and tell people what they want to hear. Unfortunately, when I tell people the truth, they get aggravated. Well, that's not what I want to hear. I want to hear something that I can sink my teeth into and that I can get excited. No, what you're looking for is pie in the sky or blue sky, and I won't give it to you. I won't mislead you. I won't. What I'll tell you to do is take a free trial, download the indicators, and try it out for 5 days. See how you do. That's your answer. That's the only real answer. How does it apply to you and your lifestyle and the hours each day that you have to trade? Now, you're not going to be an expert in 5 days, okay? But you should have some kind of a feeling, you know, in your gut. Is this going to work for me or not? I mean, we know it works because Michael does it for 2 hours a day, every day in the live trading room in front of God and everybody, you know, and we record it. And we have for years. So there's no doubt that it quote unquote works. And I really don't like that term. The question, the big question is not, does it work or can you really do it? The question is, can I do it? See, that's the question you have to ask yourself. And the only way to find out that answer is to take the trial and don't just sit there and watch, but download the platform. Install the indicators, get into the simulator, start putting on, taking off trades, okay? Learn for 2 hours, take notes, and then without the sound of Michael's voice, go trade. You'll get lost, you'll be confused, you'll come back the next day with 100 questions. Perfect. We can spot you, we know that you're really trying to learn. And we're going to cater to you. We're going to make sure your questions get answered. And then the next day, when you go out on your own for 22 hours and try to trade in the sim, you'll have less questions, but you'll still have hangups. And so each day as you come back during the trial, your list of questions will get shorter and shorter and shorter until by that fourth day, you're able to actually just go out and sim and put on and take off trades. It's a wonderful thing. And you can do it, okay? Trading's not easy, but it can be simple. Jim, thank you so much for being with us, as you are every Wednesday. Appreciate everything that you bring to the show and you bring to the community. And I'll see you tonight in the partners meeting if you're there.
Yes, I will be.
All right, buddy.
Sounds good. Take care.
I'll see you tonight. Okay, guys, that's going to do it for me, too. I got to get up and get out. I got to go to a parent-teacher meeting. Crude oil, there were 75 ticks available. On the S&P, we did not trigger long or short. Okay. Bonds, we triggered 21 ticks to the short side. And then another short side trade, which gave us 9 ticks. Bonds pay $31.25 per tick, so you only need 4, okay? From 13 down to the swing low here at 09, it's 4 ticks. So that's 4 ticks, that's 21 ticks. What did I say that was, 9? From 13 down to the low at 02, 11. So that was 11. How many do you need? 4. Okay. Crude oil, 75 ticks. There, see, that's at 45.10 that David was talking to. See, when we got up here, he was telling his guys to go short back to here. Whereas last night, I was telling our guys here to go long. I mean, it's the same from here to here and here back down to here. It's the same money, right? Just one's a long trade and the other's a short trade. But that number is the same. Our numbers are the same more often than not. And when they're not identical, they're in very close proximity. Okay, that was the euro. You need 8 ticks, 1250 per tick, and we dropped to a low of 11171. So that's 29 ticks. How many do you need? 8. Okay. I need to put this back on ZSX for November. Last night, Concierge Trade Alert for the beans, ZSX, long above 890. Okay. So that was before this report came along, I guess, and blew things out of the water. Long above 890. Okay. We need 2 pennies to be done for the day. I'm assuming this is the hour the report came out. This happened at 9 a.m. this morning. We need 2 pennies. Okay. So if we're going to get long at 890, right here at 892, that's our $100 per contract per day. In that hour, 11,000 contracts were traded. So if you wanted to trade 2, 3, 5, 10, whatever level you've earned your way up to, there's volume to support it. Okay? The Dow, YM, okay, long above 16155. 16155. Come on. All right. I'm not going to fidget. It's 16155. Given this initial run up in this hour, we hit 161.80. You need 20, 161.55. You need 20 points. So you need to get to 75. The swing high was 80. And then important prices, important areas, it came back and did it again. This time it took you up to 195. So that one had 40 points, $5 per point. So you need 20 points times $5 per point. It's $100. $100 per contract per day, period. Okay. With the Dow, they don't get into ticks. They just do the points. Okay, so we've done bonds, done the ES, done the bonds, done the crude, done the euro, done the soybeans, done the Dow. Russell. Haven't done the Russell. Okay. On the Russell, consider being long above 1083. Which is... Now, when I talk about important prices, important areas, do you see how this launched, and then where did it come back to? The alert said to be long above 1083. And I'd really like to get that straight. There we go, 1083. Okay. Now, the alert went out last night at 7:40 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. So if we call it 8 o'clock, that's 20 minutes after I sent it out. That would be the 2000 hour, this hour here. So we trigger, we don't go far. But then from 1083, we actually put in a swing high up at 1094. So that's $1,100 per contract. But no, we don't expect you to get out at the last tick. Okay? I don't know how to teach you to do that. I don't know how to do it myself. What I do know how to do is to trail a stop. I know how to set a daily goal and work towards getting that. Okay? And in the Russell, you only need a move to 1184. If you get in at 83, 84, that's your $100 per contract per day. This first hour took you to 81.60 what takes you to go to break even, right? No, I'm sorry, it was 83.90. So you had 9 ticks out of 10. Here you had 7 ticks out of 10. And then you had all you could want. And then it came back, came right back to the number. How many times do we see that day after day after day? It came right back to the number. Got 4 ticks below and did the same thing again. 1083 to 1093.60. Okay. And gold. We already addressed gold. We said to be short last night below 1120.50. Swing low was 1180.60. I'm sorry, 1118.60. So if it was 1850, that would be a $200 move right there. Okay, just in this hour. Here, we came within the swing low. It was 1110.80. 3 more ticks, and this would have been a $1,000 per contract move if we had dropped 3 more ticks. So we were 3 ticks shy of $1,000 per contract in this 3-hour move, okay? If you're trailing your stop, good chance on this here, you get stopped out with profit. That's a good thing, okay? So that covers it all from stem to stern. Now, these concierge trade alerts that I talk about, they can be in your inbox tonight. Send me an email, support@cfrn.net. I'll take care of you. I'll get you on the trial, and I'll put the alerts in your inbox, okay? Tonight is partners meeting, 9 p.m. Eastern. If you want to be in the partners meeting, yes, you have to be a partner. That's why it's called the partners workshop, but it's a piece of cake. If you're on the trial, Michael has already sent you an email that has all the information you need to become a partner. Maybe you took the trial some time back and you never made the decision. You've gone around, checked out a couple other trading rooms, and realized that what we have to offer makes sense. We don't say we're the best, the fastest, the tallest, but we are consistent. In our trading room, every day you see the consistency day after day after day. You can go to our website right now, download a spreadsheet that covers, I think, almost the entire last 3 years. Every trade taken, okay, and we record the trading room. Every word spoken, every trade taken. And there's one thing in this world. Now, anybody can look like a genius with a historic chart, but there's one thing you can't fake, and that's a real-time chart. And when you come into the live trading room in the morning, that's what you're going to see, is a real-time chart. Okay? If you turn on your CNBC or bring up any other platform beside it, there's no monkey business. It's real trades in real time using real money in front of real people. People just like you, okay? So come and join us. We would love to have you. Question, if you follow this method, what is the stop, please? I'm not sure which method you're referring to, Larry. Are you referring to the white bar trade we've been talking about? Are you talking about the concierge trade alerts? If you're trading the 2420 blueprint, which means you're looking for your $100 per contract per day and you're done. It's an 8-tick stop. Everything's an 8-tick stop. Everything we do in the live trading room is an 8-tick stop. Everything we do with Concierge Trade Alerts is an 8-tick stop. The only exception is for those people who have arrived at a level of success in trading and in the markets and understand the implications, ramifications, and have the account size that allows them to utilize a larger stop loss in search of greater gains. Okay? But unless you're already consistently profitable, you don't even think about that. You risk 8 ticks. You make your $100 per contract per day. You have 10 trades a day to make your $100. Every trade you do not use today rolls forward to tomorrow. They never expire. They never go bad. They just keep rolling forward. So on that tough day, when it takes 12 or 13 or 15 trades to make the $100, no big deal. You've got plenty of dry powder. You've got trades in reserve. Remember, if it takes you 10 trades every day to make the $100, in 47 trading days, you will have increased your account balance by $2,000 and you'll get a green light to add a second contract. You've doubled your pay at this point. You've gone from 100 a day to 200. Purpose of the 2420 blueprint is to take you from one contract to 20 contracts over a period of 24 months. It's all laid out in the book. It's in the members area waiting for you. So if I can help you in any way, email me support@cfrn.net. Give us a call, 949-42-EMINI. If you want to be in the workshop tonight, we'll put a rush on your paperwork. Call 949-42-EMINI. Say, I'm ready. I want in. We'll get you the link over. We've got all that taken care of. Get your credentials, your password, your user ID, everything you need. Get your platform in your hands. Get your indicators in your hands. And when you become a partner, you own the indicator set for life. Okay? All right. Thank you all so much for tuning in today. Whoever you are, wherever you are, may God continue to richly bless you with his mercy and with his grace. And I'll see you at the bell.
Remember this, there is no greater return on investment than to see a human life changed and given hope. As always, pray hard and trade safe. Any financial information discussed on this show is simply the opinion of our host, Dwayne Reeves, his co-hosts, and guests. To learn more about trading E-mini futures or to take a one-week free trial in our live trading room, call 1-866-928-3310. 866-928-3310. Information discussed on this radio program should not be construed as a recommendation to buy or sell any security. Always do your own due diligence and consult with a licensed securities broker or financial planner before making any investment decision.
This podcast is brought to you by System Runner. To test drive a breakthrough in